Sorry. Okay. Yes, here we go. What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of Rashad Reviews. I am your host. What should I be? I'll be Jaundice Jarrell today, or no?
You already did that.
Yeah, I did that one.
That was.
Give me another. Give me another adjective.
Jerky Jarrell.
Jerky Jarrell here with my co-host, Big League Stew, and Snarky Mark makes his triumphant return.
Yeah.
In case you guys heard last week's show or last time's show, he was out, which we had a great fill-in from Greg from the Backer Superheroes. I want to thank him for coming out to the show and lending his expertise on what did he talk about? His music, the music scene, and everything he had to say about the Birdman situation on that radio station.
He did some plugs.
He did some plugs, yes. He was a great guest. I'm really happy to have him here, and you guys should check out that band sometime. But if you're new to the show, this is how the show works. We kick back. We take some shots of a different theme alcohol, have some beers, and we talk about albums that came out in the past week, and we give our opinion on that. We also give our opinions on news topics as well. What's going on in news, we'll talk about that as well, give you our opinion on the music topics. Plus, we have, my show notes say, we also have some emails to get to. We actually had an email from Mark a few weeks ago. I held on to it for you. We'll read it today, as well as other emails we've got in the past few weeks.
Is this a different Mark?
What?
Who did you get an email from?
To Mark, not from
Mark. Oh, to Mark.
Sorry about that, guys.
You getting your own emails? I mean, they didn't even address us.
To Mark. You suck. Signed, yeah. Mark.
I was going to say, it's got to be hate mail.
It's got to be hate mail, man.
If it's from himself, it definitely is hate mail. So what album are we reviewing today? All right, first up, I know you guys have been waiting for this. Beyoncé dropped her album out of nowhere.
Yeah.
The lemonade is here. Ready to be drank and quenched for all you guys.
She had to pop a squat to drop that one.
Yes, and we'll finally give you guys the opinion of that album. It's been all over the media. Everyone's talking about that. Drizzy Drake dropped his album too. Giving us the views from his hometown. He'll be telling us about that album. Two big albums we're going to be talking about. And make that three. Pepper, the band Pepper, has their new album that came out. Half of you might be saying, isn't that that band that had that song like 14 years ago? Yes. And the other half of you guys saying,
oh, really?
Who the hell is Pepper?
What song 14 years ago?
We'll talk about that later. Sue must have been avoiding the radio.
Because I had heard the name before, but like, yeah. I thought it was like something a little bit newer and fresher.
You must have been avoiding the radio all six times they play that song on the radio. All six times you missed it.
Yeah, I didn't know that they were ever popular.
Oh, but you know that song I'm talking about?
No.
All right.
I know what the logo for the band looks like.
Yeah.
I've seen the album covers, but I've never listened to them. All three of these records this week, I felt like were interesting to me because they're groups I've known about for a long time or people.
Or singly,
yeah. But like Beyonce, other than like Destiny's Child stuff and a few of her singles, I don't know her music that much. Like, I don't know what to expect.
That's awesome, man.
Drake, same thing. Like,
okay.
I've heard the name. I know he raps, and I've heard like "Running Through the Six with My Woes."
Yeah,
that's all I know before this album.
And then, let me ask you this: Have you've heard their music besides that song? Right, you've heard enough songs.
Who, Drake?
Both of them, both those two.
Well, Drake, I really only know like one song, like that song from the last that mixtape he put out. But yeah. I know
this will be interesting, man.
I've heard Hotline Bling recently. Yeah, but that's.
How could you not?
Yeah.
But this will be a very interesting review, guys. And, all right. Yeah, I'm sorry. Guy's getting mad at me. I forgot to introduce. Guys, before I introduce a very special guest, let you know we have when we do shots, we need to let you guys know when it's time for shots. And us as well. So, we have a mascot on the show that lets us know when it's shots time. Little John from the East Side Boys is here. And he always lets us know when it's time for the shot. So if you want to have shots with us as well, when you hear this, it's time for some drinks. Little John, set us off. Yes. Time for some drinks. Get the show on the road. I was just about to tell you guys what we're going to be actually doing news topics, but let's get these drinks out the way so this motherfucker can leave me alone.
Shit. Hey, what are we drinking today, Jarrell?
Well, Mark and Little John and Stu and everybody out there, we are drinking another brand of the drink that Stu loves so much. What is it called again?
Dr. McGill Cuddy's.
Yes, and this time the flavor today is cherry. We're going to pop our cherry with the actual cherry drink.
So yes, I've never had
We had cherry. A choice between this and butterscotch, and apparently you don't like butterscotch, Stu.
Yeah, butterscotch is all right. Yeah.
Which I learned from the movie Kids is what the actual a virgin's vagina smells like, if you remember that scene.
Oh, wow.
Butterscotch. Look that up, kids.
Yeah.
Look up that, kids. Look up kids.
That, yeah, that was a good movie.
All right, two down the hatch, guys.
Ooh, I like that.
I take the cherry immediately.
It never made much money because it didn't get in the big theaters.
Yeah, it was independent movie.
It was only, yeah, yeah.
But the shots we just had were pretty good, right? Mark liked
very,
it.
Yeah. Very cherry-like.
Yeah. I tasted the cherry before I even swallowed.
I know, I could smell it.
All right.
Ooh, that's strong cherry flavor. Not much alcohol.
Guys, I gotta get to some housekeeping thing before we actually get the show started. If you guys don't mind, housekeeping things. Housekeeping? I should have had that sample, but I didn't. First off, the radio stations. If you go to our website, you'll see that the radio stations are still not up yet. Just letting you know, this week, I will be working my ass off trying to get all the stations up so you guys can actually hear the music we play on Hybrid Radio.
Woo!
It's a very technical thing. I have to figure out actually how to stream it through the server or everything like that. It's going to take some time. I hope I have it done by Saturday, and I'll tell you why in a second.
It's going to take some web page development, too.
Yeah. Woo! And Stu actually has to actually have that come straight from the website so you can link right to where their station is playing the music. In a couple of weeks, as you know, we've been doing bi-weekly shows, but starting on May 29th, we'll be going back to doing weekly shows again. I know you two are excited about that because you missed my pretty face. Except, let me ask you guys this, Father's Day. Do you guys want to do a show or... Do you guys do things with your fathers, or do you want to just do a show late, or just not do a show at all?
It's Sunday. It's Father's Day.
Yeah, like our shows on Sundays too. But how do you feel about doing a show
late? No. Wait, is today Father's Day?
No.
Oh, thank God.
when is Father's Day?
Well, you too, man. Damn,
I know I guess, it's on. I know it's a Sunday.
Yeah, I guess because I'm actually a father, I care the most. But I'm actually it's the third Sunday of June every year.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah. No. No podcast.
Probably not, yeah.
Okay. All right, sorry, you guys. Besides that, and I think I'm going to be going to a family reunion in July, but I'll keep you guys posted on that specific day when we won't do a show. But for the most part, you'll be getting weekly shows again, and hopefully by August, we'll be like every Sunday we'll be doing shows again. And the reason why we won't be doing a show next week because I'm going to Austin. This Saturday, I'll be out in Austin promoting the website on another podcast called DoubleToasted.com. I'm going to stay a little bit and see what all the great sites are. And I know my guy to my left right here has been to Austin before, which is kind of funny because when I texted you, remember that? I'm like, oh, you want to, how you been doing? Because I hadn't seen him in a long time after our store, we worked at Close. And you were like, oh, you text me back. You're like, I'm in Texas. I'm like, huh. All the places in Texas, where could Mark possibly be? I'm like, Austin? He's like, yeah. I'm like, why is he not in Dallas and Houston or San Antonio or whatever? Why were you in Austin? Is because it's probably the most liberal place in Texas possible to go. It's
pretty much, yeah.
But
weird little place,
I guess, that exists. What can you tell me that I should do? Like, I mean, I'll ask the natives when I get there, but what did you actually do while you were there?
I mean, you gotta eat barbecue.
Yeah, I'll do that.
There's a few.
Now it's beef barbecue, not pork barbecue, right?
Mostly beef. Yeah, but
you're saying I gotta have the brisket, right?
Yeah, okay. Definitely go. I know there's new places popping up all the time. There's a lot of food trucks in Austin too, so like check out some food trucks. There's there's good like nightlife.
Okay.
You go to like. 6th Street, I think it is.
I was waiting for you to finally say that.
And, yeah, I mean, it's just bars and music venues on either side of the street for like four or five blocks.
Okay. You know,
it's like, and I mean, walking around just the city, because Austin's an interesting area because it's like, there's like a city part, and then there's like suburby parts, and it's just like
ghetto.
There is a ghetto too, sure. Yeah,
ghetto.
Yeah. But the but there's like it's you can go from like being, you know, in a really countryfied area to then being in like a city area in like 5 minutes. You know, you could be at the watering hole and then you drive 5 minutes and you're in downtown where there's like sky rises and shit, you know? So it's like you get sort of a little bit of everything. It's a really nice city to walk around in. And even at night, I mean, I went once during South by Southwest, which is just nuts.
It's opposite of what I'm doing.
Everywhere. Yeah, yeah. It's crazy, 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 crazy. And I went there once out, you know, when it wasn't South by Southwest. And like just walking the streets at night is like, you're like, oh man. I don't feel like I'm going to get murdered.
Okay.
Except when you turn a corner and there's like nobody. Uh-huh. And you're like, just, I think from, it's really for me, from being in this area, like if you're like in a city at night and it's dark,
there's someone around.
There's going to be someone lurking and you're like, who am I going to run into?
But you didn't go by yourself though. Did you went with someone?
It was me and Bree. You know,
I'm going alone, so that's why, should I be scared or?
No.
Okay.
I really felt like totally safe.
Clench them cheeks.
You know? Yeah. I mean, there's the area where there's lots of there's people because it's like there's the campus there also. It's University of Texas. But yeah, it's like it's a college town mixed with just sort of a cultural area. You know, there's lots of culture. There's lots of art and weird shit. And like I said, you know, it's mostly for me, like the big thing is always food. So I'm always like, where's the good food places to eat? There's a good like there's, you know, Alamo Draft House is big there, so there's like a couple locations you can go see some cool shit probably.
And I was gonna try to see some movies there, but I didn't see when I looked at the list. I didn't see anything movies I wanted to see that actual weekend. I want to see
special events and stuff too.
Yeah,
like live shows and stuff.
Want to do some karaoke? Want to eat some barbecue? Want to walk up down Sixth Street? Do all that stuff? You know, I don't know what to do in the daytime. That's the only thing, but I'll figure it out if
well, even the day. I mean, just walking around is beautiful there.
They say that's the actual alcoholics, like, you know, that's where alcoholics live in Austin. So it's a shame you didn't get to go with me on this stuff too.
Well, you know.
You know, alcohol is alcoholics paradise,
money's,
they say.
Money's just tight, that's all.
Yeah,
but
I hear
they
you.
Have
not forever. It's loosening.
You're going next week?
I'm going actually this Saturday and I'll be back on Tuesday.
Yeah, a little too soon for me.
This is May. So I think they have this bat bridge is like a big thing there, where there's this bridge where a bunch of bats live underneath it, and then like at night during the summertime, and it might be time enough now where they come out.
Dusk, they all fly out.
They all fly all around the bridge. It's like this huge attraction there.
Nice.
So.
Vampires in Austin.
Yeah, and then you get bat crap all over you. Guano, but right, isn't it?
Guano.
Shikaka.
Bumblebee tuna. But, yeah, no, it's a cool city. Definitely enjoy it, and get up early if you want some really good barbecue because there's places that open.
I'm
at like
not
10
fucking
o'clock.
Going to that fucking place with the lines like 4 hour away. I'm not going to that
you, man,
one.
I'm sure it's worth it. I've never. I went.
I heard it is, but I'm not waiting that 4 hours for barbecue. It can't be that good.
Yeah.
I forgot the name of the place, but I'm sure they'll tell me when we get there. Or you guys from Austin actually listen to the show because I know our fan base goes all over the world globally, and you're just too shy to email us. But yeah, let me know like what the best place to go to Austin. I will be there actually this Saturday. I'll have my Hybrid Radio t-shirt on. If you see me at any bars, come and say what's up to me. Anyway, news topics that we're going to be talking about. I actually picked a news topic for all three of us. You know what? I'll tease that later.
What news topic? All
right,
because it feels like I might as well go into it, but I had another thing I want to talk about with you guys. So we're doing the show actually here at actually, did you listen to the show last week, Mark?
I did not. No.
Steve, if you want to tell me if you agree, I am so happy that Clinda, who actually we lets us use her place for the Hybrid Radio Studios. Not tonight, today, because she had an issue with her cat, so we're recording actually in my place. But
yeah, her cat's ill.
The last show we did, she was actually on vacation at the Bermuda Triangle getting her Gomez Adams thing on, you know. Out on a cruise out there, the Bermuda Triangle, remember that?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So her actual cousin, her boyfriend, who is my cousin-in-law, was letting us do the show there. And when I listened to the audio, you could hear him talking throughout the whole show. And you remember when I'd be like, you know, calm down, Jay. He's like, no, this is my place. You shut the fuck up. I'm talking what I want to talk. Remember that?
Yeah.
Attitude and stuff. I'm like, you know what? I'm not going to get started.
He was so loud.
But you can hear it on the show. But I'm so happy that Clinda's back. And taking back control of the house. So next time we do a show there, I promise you guys, besides this show, there won't be anybody talking over our reviews and stuff.
I don't think... Yeah, but see, he instantly regretted it by the end of the show because what were we taking shots of?
We were taking shots of Purple Rain.
Purple Rain.
I made it myself.
And it was a mixed drink and had alcohol and it was real light. And so every time we would take a shot, he'd be taking a shot of what was it? Not whiskey.
He had some kind of whiskey that was like
freaking 90 proof or whatever. And then he's knocking those back, every single one of our little water drinks that we drank. By the end of it, he's almost throwing up.
Yeah.
And he's like, I shouldn't have done that.
Almost throwing up. He actually did puke. He was in the bathroom for a while.
Yeah, he did throw up.
All right. So so now this show, actually, we don't have to worry about that going on. Let's get into the how was your Mother's Day, you guys, real quick? And then we'll get into the everything. Mother's Day good?
Mother's Day good? Yeah.
That's why we didn't do a show last week.
Mother's Day. Mother's Day was all right.
Do you splurge like crazy for your mama?
Yeah, I did what I could.
Yeah, I bought a $6 card at Target.
Oh, man.
I didn't realize it was $6 until I got to the cash register.
That's what...
She even commented. She was like, this is not a 99-cent card. Like, you picked a good... I gave her a card.
Mark probably found out it was $6 when the lady said the price. So he stood there for a second. What? Shit. I'm already here in the line behind me.
I grabbed the card. I was like, oh, shit, Mother's Day's coming up. I grabbed the card. I put it in. I was like, it's fine. Then when I went home, I realized it said something about, like, no matter how far apart we are. And I was like, I guess it doesn't really apply. We don't live that far away. It's not like we're miles apart.
Well, you're not networked there right now, so technically you're not in the same room.
What was that? That's what I figured.
Yeah, it's kind of funny how Mother's Day and Father's Day, like, differ. Because at my second job where I work at, like, people are opposite of you. They're coming in shopping for cars, like, all the past 2 weeks. But then when Father's Day comes around, it's, like, the last day. Then they come and get cards. And even the commercial, like, don't forget Mother's Day. Don't forget Mother's Day. It's very important. And then Father's Day, it's like, oh, yeah. If you're not doing anything today, Father's Day.
I understand.
Get a card.
He's not sensitive. He's the rock.
You know what's funny?
He's the rock.
Yeah, I think that's true. Because it's like, I'm thinking to myself, like, most dads just want, like, the card, the breakfast maybe, and just be left alone to watch the game. I mean, if that's wrong or not right, I mean, I'm a dad. I'm not really like, I want to watch the game, but I don't really need a gift that day, but... I'm glad you guys did a good thing for your mothers and did the best you can. Some people actually spend like almost $200 on their moms. No. So I felt guilty for a second until I heard your $6 card story. So I'm like, all right.
$6 card, we paid for, you know, we had like brunch or whatever.
Oh, that's sweet. Yeah. Where'd you guys go? Anything special?
We was a place in Morristown.
Called McDonald's.
Called the Famished Frog. I don't know. It was like me, my parents, my grandmother, my aunt. My cousin,
I've her heard boyfriend, of okay,
a bunch of people. It was all right.
All the bill was on you, right?
No.
Okay. We're going Dutch, right, Mom?
No, it's this weird shit. My family, like my parents, are always just like, "Oh, we'll take care of it." Like they're very nice.
Pulling the check on the table like back and forth.
Not like they're like rich, but if we go out to dinner, usually they'll take care of it. But recently, we've been going out with like my aunt. My aunt has this new thing now, I guess just because her daughter now is with a guy and I guess they're working and she realized, oh shit, I don't have to pay for everything that my daughter does. Now she has this new thing where she's like, oh no, we're all paying separately, right?
Right.
Which then pissed me off because going into this dinner, knowing that we were going to pay for our own meal and then they fucking split it evenly between everyone and I'm like, you guys had a fucking glass of wine, you had a fucking mixed drink, you had two mixed drinks, you had dessert, and you got the filet mignon.
I don't like when you have alcohol and food and then they go to split the bill.
And I'm like, we owe $25 because we both got burgers. And
there should be two different sets of bills. Exactly. One for alcohol, one for food.
Waiter, can I get a separate bill for the alcohol, please? Oh, yes. More shots. Obviously, Lil Jon wants to pick up the party a little bit. Don't get us too drunk, Lil Jon, because we got reviews to this. I get the point, Lil Jon. You want us to move along, we'll do it. But can I ask you a question?
I went to a show.
You did. I bet Stu said he's went to a show. He's going to tell us he went to Brooklyn. And a little segment I wanted to let you guys know I'm trying to do actually with Mark is every month I want to have a show where he can talk about movies he saw with him and his girl and say what he thought of it and then have a movie show. Yeah, for him. Called Mark's like Movies, Monthly Movies. Triple M.
Whatever.
So Mark was telling me a couple months ago that he watched this movie with Tina Fey. All right, let's take these shots.
He already sang to us.
Got you. Sorry. Mark was talking a couple weeks ago that he watched the movie with Tina Fey. Ensemble cast, Jason Bateman. about like a dysfunctional family that I guess their someone in their family died, so they had all come together for a funeral, and then they were like fighting with each other, shit like that. And I'm like, that reminds me of a movie I actually saw called Eulogy, starring the great Zooey Deschanel and Ray Romano.
Yeah.
And I was like, you should watch this movie because I thought it was better. So I actually have it and let him borrow it. And he just brought it back to me today. He watched it. And it's actually a movie from 2004. So it obviously predates it. So, Mark, what did you think of this film?
Yeah, me and my girlfriend, we both really liked it a lot, you know? I was telling you before, like, we watched it yesterday.
Right.
You know, I've had it for a month now, I guess.
He's but, like, I guess I'll check it out.
It's like when someone lends you something, sometimes it's just like, it's not, it was given to me, but it's not something that I picked.
Now, let's keep in mind, when you let me borrow those Bobcat Goldwick dark comedies, like, let me tell you guys, this is a dark comedy, too. We're on this dark comedy, like, thing going on. You let me borrow those two movies he did, the Robin Williams movie, and you let me borrow God Bless America? I think you did, or did I watch it on Netflix?
It was on Netflix. I never saw it. Like, I never owned it. All
right, so, you let me borrow one, and I watched it immediately. Apparently, you can't do that for me, but okay.
Well, whatever. But anyway, put it off to the last minute, of course. I was like, all right, gotta do the podcast tomorrow. We have to watch this movie. Well, honestly, if I was, you know, we've been watching some good stuff, and we went to the movies a bunch of times. Every time I was like, it was like between this and something else. It was just the other one was more to what we wanted.
Okay.
Anyway, but really liked it a lot. You know, I thought like there's some really great comedic moments in it. There's some really great sad moments in it, and there's one of the most realistic pot smoking scenes I've ever seen.
Yes, yes.
What makes it more realistic? Like he was like breaking it up.
Now keep in mind, like, keep you guys up there. Stu actually saw this movie two times and has no idea about this film.
What movie?
Eulogy.
This one. Ray Romano.
I still don't remember that movie.
There's a scene where there it's like all the grown up kids. So it's like Ray Romano, Hank Azaria,
Kelly Preston girls. Actually, who's married to John Travolta. This is her pre Scientology days.
I guarantee you, I was not sober when I watched it.
You weren't both
but
times.
There's a scene where like the girls they're smoking weed, they're passing a joint around, and like the one girl's she's talking to them, and she's like making some kind of point, and then she just stops in the middle of the sentence and stands there, and they're like. Like, what do you mean? What? Like, continue. And then she's like, what? And then, like, they're like, you were saying this? And she's like, oh, shit. Okay. And, like, totally spaces. Yeah, and then, like, does this. It was literally being stoned while watching it. I was like, that's exactly how I feel right now. I completely understood.
She started totally a fucking happens. Story about her sister. And she's like, oh, and then, like, next week. And then she passed a joint. And then and they're like, okay. What about next week? And she's like, what about next week? And she's like, what are you talking about? And then she's like, you were telling a story. It's like, I was? And then they had to remind her what the story was, and she was telling it and like laughing at the same time. Like, yeah, you already said that part. Skip ahead. And then the story had no point, but it was just was so authentic. That was really so great about it. But did you like the movie better than the movie you were saying it was so great? This is Where I Leave You was the movie you were talking about? That was my point of loneliness to you.
Okay. It's hard to say.
They both have twists.
They're both good. Yeah. They're both good. I mean, if I knew that you were going to ask me this question, I would have watched the other one again.
Oh, really?
I have this thing where I don't know. Especially with this whole thing that we're doing, we're trying to watch a movie every day, so it's like we were talking about things the other day. I was like, "Did we watch Walk Through the Tombstones?" And she was like, "Yeah, we totally watched that." Mm. I was like,
"That's Liam Neeson."
Yeah, you watching a movie every day, you're gonna start forgetting. Yeah. Your brain's gonna make room for the new movies. Yeah, exactly.
That's a good point. So if we do this show, can you remember 30 movies in a month, or will you want to cut it down to like 10? Because if he does 30 movies, he can have a longer podcast.
Look, your brain's gonna explode.
I'm just gonna go through the, like. I remember the gist of it.
Okay.
But I honestly, once I watched the trailer, I was like, oh, I do remember that.
Well, okay. Yeah, you do know if it sucks or not. Mm.
Yeah, but I mean, I wouldn't spend much time talking about anything other than the good ones, probably.
Yeah. Like, and the bad ones. Just like say what sucked about ones and what were good about one.
As a short thing, I'll say we saw a couple movies in the theater recently. We saw Batman vs. Superman, which I know you guys saw.
Yeah.
I liked.
Yeah. I hate.
It wasn't the worst, but it could have been better.
Did you see Civil War?
We saw Civil War. Fucking loved it.
It blows that movie out the water, right?
Oh, yeah.
I want to see Civil War.
Me too.
General, the Marvel movies are definitely better so far. Yeah. But it's whatever. I mean, I think they killed it with Spider-Man in that. Like,
oh, they did. It looks like it looks corny, but it's gonna be good.
Young Spider-Man, CGI, right?
No, no, new Spider-Man, fucking great.
Young, okay. It's young, like he's teen young, Spider-Man.
He like is talking. He's in like one big action scene, and he fucking delivers. Like, all right, makes that.
We gotta
scene
see that
really
sometime.
Great.
You
and
have
there's
to,
another thing.
You have to pay for my ticket this time. That's probably why he liked the Batman vs Superman so much, because he got a free fucking.
How
show
did I get a
that.
Free ticket?
I paid for you, motherfucker.
I don't remember you paying for me.
Of course you don't. You don't remember Eulogy. You don't remember me paying for you. What do you remember, man?
No, I don't remember. Oh wait, yeah, maybe you did pay for me.
Yeah, Civil War is great.
Yeah, but you owe me money, so.
And then we saw Green Room. I don't know if you know that movie.
Sounds familiar.
It's basically punks versus Nazi skinheads.
Oh, so.
With Patrick Stewart and
Odd
Thomas.
It looks scary.
It's really good.
Yeah.
It's intense.
Yeah, intense.
It's like the whole movie you're on edge, but really crazy and really good.
It's the girl's fault that she shouldn't have gone back there, right? It's what start the whole thing off?
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay.
I mean,
she just left instead of seeing that dead body, but spoilers. all right, so great, we went with that. I know you're on edge, too. Tell us about your Brooklyn thing, and then we'll get into the news.
Oh, well, I'm not really on edge. I wanted to get it out and then get it over with.
All right, get your fantastic story of what you did this weekend over with.
Went to a show, Brooklyn. Saw who opened up. It was the High School Football Heroes. You ever hear of them?
That's not Gym Class Heroes?
No, High School Football.
Okay. Okay.
Are they a punk band or?
Yeah.
Okay.
Like punk ska.
Okay.
They were good.
Were they all a bunch of jocks and shit?
No.
Wearing varsity jackets
and then I saw Big Wig, which
they're good.
Big
man.
Wig only plays like twice a year in the city.
Yeah.
So you got
they're
to see
them. They're
in New
Jersey, aggressively ska punk band.
Yes.
Yeah.
They were very good.
Are they ska?
No, it's punk, but they have that, you know, that chunk 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 chunk.
Okay.
The guitar like ska.
All right.
But it's a little faster, you know, harder, you know.
It's like an angrier Operation Ivy.
Yeah. So there's some good dancing, and one little idiot tried to ruin it. And
what'd you do?
No, it wasn't me.
Okay.
So this kid goes in the pit and just starts swinging his arms in circles, like trying to punch everyone.
Trying to.
Yeah. And he was a little skinny kid. All of a sudden, everyone's eyes light up. And everyone just ran and clobbered him, and then somebody yoked him, and all I see is like an arm and his head like stuck in somebody's arm, and him getting pulled away. Wow. I was like, that's street justice.
That's a true punk show, man.
Yeah, street justice. Street
justice. You guys are all vigilantes at this show, man.
Yeah. Well, you have to police your own shows. You know, shows when you have security, the security, they don't know when to act. They don't know when to act and when not to act, because they're not actually in the pit either. They just see a fist and they're like, "Ooh, you're out of here." Mm-hmm. You know, they don't know the difference between hard dancing and somebody that's like just swinging their arms trying to punch people in the face.
I saw that actually. Remember when we went to that show at the, I hate to call this venue out, the Stone Pony, which everyone says
they
kick you out from those
they'll
guys.
Kick
are,
you out
from, those guys are roughhousing, playing, and then they fell over, and then the guys are
like,
get out.
I like the self-policing.
Yeah.
You get yoked if you do some stupid shit.
All in all, you say this is a band that we should be playing on the radio station?
Yes. Right. Big Wig is very good.
Well, we do play Big Wig, but the other band, how were they?
Oh, they were good.
All right.
Yeah.
Cool.
High school Football Heroes.
I love hearing your stories when you go do something fun instead of like just getting drunk and passing out in your backyard, you know?
Yeah. Well, I got drunk and almost passed out in Brooklyn.
You no vomiting at all?
No. Made it home on the L train and... Somehow, yeah, that's about it all I remember.
Speaking of shows, you guys heard the news, right? And I want to ask you about this. Misfits.
Oh, yes.
Misfits,
yeah.
Glenn Danzig.
Getting back together?
Yeah, Glenn Danzig.
Yeah, no, I heard that.
Whenever I read Misfits are playing here or there, I'm like, who gives a fuck? Like, it's no Glenn Danzig. Who cares? But when I saw that news this week, Glenn Danzig and Doyle are going to be back playing with Jerry Only, who's carrying the torch of this band that's been dead since, like, you know, 1983, but whatever.
83. Oh, my God. Yeah, how old is he now, though? He doesn't look that old.
The bass player? And he's a bass player still holding on to this band. It's like, dude, even the singer's gone. Let it go. But he's still in the band, and they're actually playing two shows, right? At Riot Fest.
I didn't see what the shows were.
They're playing two shows at Riot Fest, two shows in Denver. And then the one in Chicago, and I'm like, I guess you don't give a shit, Mark. But I was kind of on the fence. Like, once a lifetime opportunity, but maybe they might tour, and if they do, it'll sell out immediately at Starline Ballroom in Sayreville, New Jersey. I'm fucking there. Now I want to ask you guys this: like, how do you feel about all these what do you want to call these reunions?
Cash grabs.
Cash grabs.
All right, let's say that GNR, Alice Cooper, I heard is doing the original members are getting back together to do a show. Obviously, I was talking to you guys last week about Smashing Pumpkins.
They've been doing it with hardcore every year, the Black and Blue Bowl. They bring back all the old hardcore bands.
Yeah, but that's just one day. I'm talking about these bands are touring. Like, I heard Billy Corgan from Smashing Pumpkins is actually talking to Darcy, just talking to her. So maybe she might end up touring with them, and they got the drummer back, right? Is Jimmy, officially, Chamberlain, is he officially there?
I guess so. I don't know. I don't keep up to the Misfits.
Yeah, so you don't give a fuck about the Misfits, but if that Smashing Pumpkins happens...
I like the Misfits. They're not...
see them live?
I mean, it's one of those things where, a Misfits show in 82, let's say that's before they went bad, I guess, to your timeline.
Yeah.
And then versus a Misfits show in 2016 or 17.
Yeah.
Is going to be a lot different. I mean...
But you're seeing the same dudes, though.
You're seeing the guys who made those songs.
They're just going to be a little slower.
But yeah, they're going to be slower.
That's the whole issue why I don't...
Danzig,
they might have to do more bathroom breaks.
I got to pee out this, fucking boulder out of my dick. It's like... It's like why I will never see... I love Bad Brains, but whenever they're playing, I'm like, I don't want to see this 70-year-old man, playing this hardcore shit. It's not gonna happen. They're gonna play all reggae stuff, but I'm talking Glenn Danzig is still doing the metal shit, so possibly it could be good.
Yeah, but I mean, even Danzig, I just feel like his voice just isn't what it used to be. I mean, he's still Danzig, but
yeah.
I mean,
Where was Glenn Danzig originally from?
Around here, I think.
Yeah, they're from New Jersey. There's actually
I believe it was White House, New Jersey.
They're from from
literally from, in this area.
No, they're from Fort Lee, up north.
Near right.
Bayonne area. Because actually, and this is there's a dude who lived next door to a former friend of mine.
He's dead now, or he just don't like him.
He doesn't talk to me anymore. Okay. He moved across the country and didn't tell me, so I'm like, I guess we're not friends anymore. But I used to do a podcast with him, actually.
Okay.
And he, his next door neighbor.
We got him now, motherfucker.
His next door neighbor grew up with Danzig and knew all of them. And they used to, and he told us all these crazy stories. It's like, we used to call Glenn a little rat face boy. Okay. Yeah, because he had a huge nose and his hair, he would just keep his hair in front of his face. He looked like a little rat face.
I just picture they're pushing him down the mud, look at little Glenn Danzig. I'm going to be a band one day. I'm going to be cool. Yeah, I'll see you guys do that.
Wait till I work out.
he basically said that he was a little, as he called it, a little puke who wanted to be all the other tough guys. They used to smash up the fucking post office window or something like that. They threw a mailbox through it or something. And then Glenn Danzig went to Europe for a little while, came back all buff and was the
talk about zombies and shit.
Yeah, it was so that's
I want your skull.
That was the inside scoop on Danzig and stuff. Actually, speaking of bands getting back together.
All right, you got a better one than the four I mentioned? Go ahead.
New Brunswick, pop punk legends, the Ergs. If anyone's familiar with the Ergs.
I actually hear the crickets.
I hear legend all over. I hear legend and then... Yeah,
crickets. Once he dropped that name, me and Steve were just what?
They're a little, maybe they're young, after your time of but the Ergs, fucking amazing band, pop punk, I bet you would love them.
He should have said Instant or something like that.
But they broke up in 2006 and played their last shows at the Asbury Lanes. I was there, I saw them a bunch of times in Brunswick basements and stuff. They toured and they're legends at The Fest in Florida, which is a huge... pop punk festival around Halloween time.
Okay.
They recently, there's a show called the Chris Gethard Show, which is it used to be a New York public access show that now is on Fusion, which is apparently a cable network. Yeah. Anyway, Chris Gethard, also from New Brunswick, he got them to reunite on his show this past week, which made me really happy. But they just announced also that they're reuniting and they're going to play at the Fest this year, which is not till October. So okay. they might. I'm hoping that they stay together a little bit. I mean, they're dudes that I know. Like I've hung out with them a bunch, but they're one of those bands that I'm like,
yeah,
they're amazing. Like watching them play together again, and like there was like a video of them playing the show.
What broke them up to begin with?
I mean, there's different.
Slept with somebody else's girlfriend.
I think at the time there was a lot of just different directions of
drugs,
individual lives going different ways. It's three dudes. One of them.
I want to get married. I want to go to college.
Yeah.
I don't want to put my own what I thought into it, but
all right. You're friends with them, so you can just always ask, or actually get the interview from me. I'll interview them and ask that question.
Yeah, you could. Well, if you know the band Nightbirds, have you heard of that band?
Yes.
So Joe, the bass player for Nightbirds, what used to be Joe Erg.
Okay.
He's one of the Ergs. And then, yeah, anyway.
So you guys out there, let us know what reunion tour are you excited about. Email us that. Are you excited about the dismal Guns N' Roses reunion or the Smashing Pumpkins or the Misfits?
Pumpkins.
Or the Ergs.
Or the Ergs.
The Ergs is like probably the biggest thing here. Email us at njhybridradio.
I'm going to get my high school band back together.
Oh, okay.
Oh, no, I had two high school
You
got to
tell us about that story sometime later.
No, that's not really not happening.
You're telling the story someday about your previous life, man. Those are some good stories, man.
Oh.
All right, so njhybridradio@gmail.com. Email us about anything you want to say about that. And with that, it is time for some music news. Or some shots, sorry. Got it to be easy on the our friend Mark here, man. We just got him back.
My cherry's gonna be shit scented.
You had some family.
My shit is gonna be cherry scented.
my cherry's gonna be shit scented.
I totally said that backwards.
This cherry smells like shit.
That's classic alcohol right there.
You guys hashtag that as soon as we get a Twitter thing going on. Which actually, Clinda said that she's gonna do a Twitter thing for us. So to Glenda for pulling her weight. Clink. They're not loud enough.
Well, is she gonna keep the is she gonna be the one answering our Twitter mails?
She'll give me the tweets and the Instagrams and stuff like that.
Tweets.
I would have talked to her about it today, but we had to do the show here, so I'll talk to her about it later. Anyway, time for some music news. Now, I said the news that we have today is for all three of you. Each story involves all three of us in some way, or interests us in all some way. First off, we'll start with Stu here. Stu, yeah. I have a story for you that you're going to be interested about.
All right.
Some local news for Stu.
Local news. Who got murdered?
Rapper 50 Cent. You remember him?
Got murdered.
Well, he got shot 9 times and survived. You know that, right?
Yeah, but not all at once.
Yes, all at once.
Oh, it was all at once?
Damn, it's the 7th time I got shot. Better not happen again. G-U-Nut. He was, actually at the airport in Kentucky. You guys heard this story?
Oh,
no,
yeah,
okay. Totally. So he's at the airport in Kentucky, you guys out there.
I got a shitty news story.
Go
on.
And he's a big Instagram guy now. He actually gets paid for all his Instagram posts. Every time he posts something, he gets paid because he has that many followers.
And somebody Instagrammed, "I just shot you."
Yeah, yeah.
And shot him?
He saw somebody
really
working there, and he decided to videotape him, put him on Instagram, and he's like, "Look at this guy. He's fucked up." And he videotaped a guy pushing his garbage as a janitor. And he looked at him, and he said, "Your eyes are all messed up. Look at the kids today. All fucked up." And stuff like that.
Oh, he was autistic.
Yes. Found out later he's an autistic kid. And, The family got mad about that, and they're suing him for, a lot of money. So he decided to apologize about that.
Doesn't he not have money anymore?
Apparently, he's broke, but he put on Facebook or Instagram that he put, all his money, and he spelled out broke in, $100 bills. And he was like, "Oh, I'm broke." And he's like, "Oh, that was fake money." He's like, "No, that money looks real. You're a liar." Anyway, so the reason I want to talk to you about this is he actually has an alcohol called effing vodka. You guys heard of his vodka?
Nope.
Yeah, well, he was trying to promote it in Hillsborough.
Yes, you know the story.
Yes.
All right, so Stu actually is from Hillsborough, New Jersey. I am too, but I'm living out here. We're in an undisclosed location. You already know. You already look at the website. I'm in Raritan, but I'm not giving you the address. So Stu lives in Hillsboro, and there's a Bottle King out there that sells all alcohol. He was going to do a promotion there, which, if you remember, Stu, a couple last year, one of the actors from the movie A Bronx Tale, Chaz.
Chaz Palminteri.
Yeah, he signed that bottle you see right there on top of my refrigerator.
Is it signed? It's a signed bottle.
So I sat in line.
So you could have had a
I was so excited because 50 Cent was supposed to be doing a promotion there yesterday, but Bottle King canceled that after that video of him mocking the autistic kid surfaced. And I got this story from Patch.com, and it says the Bottle King in Hillsboro has canceled an appearance with the rapper 50 Cent after he made a video mocking the man with autism.
I'm in there every day. I would have just walked in, and 50 Cent would have been there.
I know. 50 Cent in Hillsboro. And it's a tiny town.
Did you move the gin? 50 Cent?
I know. The way if you wouldn't recognize him at being in your drunk stupor, who knows? So, actually, Saturday, May 14th, he was supposed to be there at the Hillsboro Bottle King in Route 206. And after the video was made public, the company canceled the appearance. And additionally, Bottle King has removed all effing vodka. Why did he call it that? Get the effing vodka. Get the effing vodka out here right now. Maybe that's why they call it that for the double entendre, right? You got any effing vodka here? They removed all the products from the shelves effective immediately. And then a spokesperson from Bottle King says, as a family-owned company, we believe that respect and inclusions are the pillar in which the communities we serve are built upon, and alcoholics as well.
So get drunk.
The recent actions by 50 Cent are in direct contrast with those fundamental principles and will not be tolerated by our organization.
That is not good vibes.
I want to ask you guys, what do you guys think about the whole thing that happened, what went down? First, my wife said that people in being famous, Mrs. S, you guys know from other shows, said in people in the famous atmosphere should really tone down on their whole Twitter and like Instagram like actions and not post everything because it blows up and you eventually get these endorsement deals like get canceled, you know? So what do you guys think about the whole thing? You first, both of you waiting for the other person to talk.
Good riddance. No, no, no. I definitely do agree that, you know, celebrities need to be more conscientious of what they post to Twitter or Instagram or Facebook. But, I mean, so should everybody. You know, that's the thing, too. It's like, there's also stories of just random, you know, real people who post something stupid and then the internet all of a sudden gets behind them and is like, let's tear this person down.
Good point.
I heard a really crazy story on NPR at one point about this girl who tweeted something real stupid, like right before getting on a plane to like Africa. Like she was going there for like some sort of thing and she posted like, hope I don't get AIDS, like something real stupid.
Okay, that sounds familiar. Ignorant. I think I heard that story.
And then by the time her plane landed, she had gotten fired from her job. The entire internet swelled up to hate, you know, to hate on her. News stories broke out against this lady. Like her entire life was over by the time she like landed, turned on her phone and was like, okay, like, what happened?
Yeah.
And, you know, it's like one of those things where, you know, should you be able to post something real stupid? And, you know, but they can't, how do we police?
Well, that means she would have to have sex with people in Africa.
Yeah.
How's that hateful?
That would mean she's at least open to that idea, yeah. It was something to do
with AIDS. I'm having unprotected sex, hoping I don't get AIDS.
I'm not quoting it directly.
Yeah.
But it was, whatever. Anyway, I think that, on a whole, our culture is really going towards this weirdly sensitive place where everybody needs to be included. We can't say anything bad about anybody, which I both agree with and disagree with. You know, okay. Like on the one hand, I feel like there should not be censorship about things because who's to say that I can't write whatever I feel like?
Yeah.
That's not to say that I shouldn't be chastised for having a terrible opinion about somebody.
Yeah. Know? Yeah. That's why I was almost like, where are you going? You're going back and forth on this. Cause the kid, keep in mind, he's making fun of an autistic kid just working.
Yeah. But you know, it's one of those things where you're like,
did he really know?
Yeah. He didn't know.
He didn't know the kid's autistic. He just thought he looked stupid. And that's the thing is like, well, when do you just keep your opinion?
He's probably never seen an autistic kid before.
Yeah. I'm not going to disagree that he shouldn't be writing any shit dissing some random kid pushing garbage around because he fucking can spell out, even if he could spell out the word broke in, you know, $100 bills.
Like, yeah.
That's enough money that you should shut your fucking mouth. But,
yeah.
I don't know. It's like, I could see both ways on that. Because you can't have it only a little bit. You know, you have to have it all, you know, all the way. If you're talking about censoring.
I never thought about looking at it from his perspective that he's the victim here. 50 Cent.
I'm not saying he's a victim. He's still an asshole.
Yeah.
But what I'm saying is you have the right to be an asshole. And that's what the internet nowadays doesn't seem to agree with.
Yeah.
Is that people, they think you have to be, you have to say everything politically correct all the time. Everything's always going to get argued with, no matter what you say. You know,
yeah, he's supposed to be a tough, hard rapper.
Yeah,
he's not supposed to be sensitive.
Like, don't you guys feel like you're judging your friendships more now because of the Facebook and the internet? Now you know what your friends and peers are thinking.
No, before.
Well, you didn't. I didn't know.
Yeah, I've unfriended a few people.
Yeah, now you do. But if there's no Facebook, Instagram, you still be friends with them. Mm-hmm. Now you have to know what people are thinking because they have the urge to post everything they think, everything they see. And it's like, you know, now you're being judged. It sucks what the internet's doing to us. We're becoming victims and like not victims, but becoming like slaves like this whole like World Wide Web where we have to voice what we're every thought we have and everything we see. And it's his if we didn't have no Instagram, he'd be doing that shit yesterday. I could have got a fucking autograph from 50 Cent.
Well, some people drop off. Some people drop off the grid altogether. I had a friend not on Facebook anymore, not anywhere, cannot be found.
I like how, okay, that has nothing to do with anything, but cool.
No, but because of shit like this.
Okay, exactly. You went to the other, yeah, that's a good point, that's a good point. I just think that it just sucks that we're not going to be able to, that I can't get the autograph, and at the same time, this is what he has to resort to because, not saying that his first album wasn't great, but he's trying to be relevant through the internet, and that's really fucking sad, I think, for 50 Cent.
Well, that's anybody. I mean, that's any celebrity, quote-unquote, you know, no matter what level they're at, you know.
Yeah.
Well,
some celebrities can do it without. They have whatever they actually are famous for. They're still doing it, and they have that on the side to add to it. But 50 Cent, I can't remember the last album that came out. Yeah, the last album that came out that was like in the mainstream was that Curtis album that he did when it was at the same time with the Kanye West album.
Well, he had an album, Animal Ambition, that came out like a year or two ago.
Don't remember it.
No.
Exactly.
But, I mean, I don't know. This whole issue, I think, there's so many sides to it. It's hard to really pin down any one aspect of it because, you know, it's what you should be doing versus what people do. Like, you can't stop people from making fun of people.
Yeah.
You know, you can't stop people from posting on social media anymore because it's just the way of the world now. But you can choose to not follow somebody.
Yeah.
But the thing is, because everyone feels like everyone's opinion is now valid and heard through the internet, so people want to make their opinions known. So now all that, anything that's opposing someone is louder, and then obviously no one wants to come up and say, you know what, though? He's allowed to make fun of retarded people. You know, or autistic people.
You can
like,
say.
There's no voice against the people that are against him. You know, there's nothing,
because
you can't win that argument.
Right.
Although the larger argument, I think, is valid to say, like, well, we shouldn't be censoring people in general. You know, like, because what's the alternative to saying you can't tell people, you can't make fun of people online is you're not allowed to post anymore. Like with Iggy Azalea or Azalea Banks. Hot water now because she posted a bunch of shit on Twitter and got into this huge thing. Twitter like suspended her account. She started another one. They suspended that.
You're basically going with the whole, even with the Opie Anthony thing. Anthony getting fired for putting that picture. I see. Then the final question.
But that's the thing.
I see.
I agree with that because you're allowed to have your own opinion on something, and even if it's wrong,
right,
that doesn't mean that there's not going to be consequences for it.
That's what the First Amendment means. You have the right to say what you want, but the same, you can say anything you want, but you have to suffer the consequences of what your actions. I think that's totally fair. Now, final question for you, Mark, before we pass to Stu, because this is actually your story, Stu.
Sorry.
Because you're from Hillsborough, how do you feel about that? I want to ask you this question. If you were in 50 Cent's shoes...
Nobody cares about the people that actually would have been there and been like, whoa, 50
If you were in 50 Cent's Air Jordans and you get paid for everything you put on Instagram, would you be able to police what you say and post? Or do you think you'd be a victim of the same circumstance? Would you get a little flagrant what you post at that point?
I don't know. I mean, I think it also shows your character. Like, are you the kind of person who, if given money, would resort to posting, you know, making fun of people online, I'm not that kind of person. You know, okay. Like, I'm not making
Money videos. Will not sway your personality to change.
Yeah, if they're like, you're getting paid $100 every time you post something on Instagram, I'm not going to then be like, oh, sweet, so I can go make fun of garbage men. Like, that's going to be my channel. Making fun of the fucking help, you know? Like, just, I don't know. I feel like it shows what kind of person you are. And that's right. And that, in turn, is why people now, it's like, oh, great, now I can unfriend people who have the wrong opinion of mine. Yeah. You know, not mine.
That's fair. So as for you, Stu, as a Hillsborough resident, are you sad that they are taking the effing vodka off the shelves? And
well, no, I'm not sad about the effing vodka being gone, because I'm sure it's probably just vodka. There's nothing you could do with vodka other than distill it 5 times, and it's friggin' neutral grain spirits. That's why I don't understand that everyone comes out with these vodka companies. Guess what? Vodka is vodka. It's all the same shit.
Everyone should be doing moonshine.
Okay, the only difference is, like, the cheaper, like, bottom shelf shit, they don't distill it as many times, and it tastes kind of like charcoal, because they run it through a charcoal, like, cheap charcoal filter and shit. They don't spend a lot of money for the equipment. The more expensive ones are cleaner, but it's alcohol. It's pure alcohol.
Okay.
You can't really, there's no real flavor behind it. It's not like whiskey where you got like a barrel and shit that flavors it and it's got to be aged and
boom.
Yeah.
50 Cent, your fucking vodka sucks.
you just got roasted so far.
I don't really care about vodka. Like, I wouldn't promote a vodka. Yeah. Unless it was dirt cheap.
Which is vodka. The Major Sky is very cheap. Major Sky we had.
Yeah, but I don't like that. Major Sky was kind of gross. That's the shit I'm talking about, where they don't triple distill it.
The Major Sky was double distilled, and it was still too hard for Mark.
It was double distilled through a nasty charcoal. Yeah.
So what do you think of having him there yesterday? I'm kind of sad about that.
I'm disappointed because
I didn't think Bottle King was that big of a deal.
It could have put Bottle King on the map.
Yeah, I know.
That would have put Bottle King on the map.
I
know.
Who cares? I thought they should just let him be there.
I mean, that other dude, who was that guy again? You both know him.
Chaz.
I didn't fucking know that dude. But 50 Cent, everybody's going to know who the fuck 50 Cent is, no matter what he said.
Yes,
yeah,
good point.
I'm sure you would have people that would go in there and be like, yeah, fuck them retards. It's Hillsborough. You know.
I'm retarded too. Yeah. All right.
No, but I would have liked to see them. I mean, it sucks that they canceled it.
Yeah, Bottle King fucked
up. They didn't think about the people in Hillsborough. I guess they didn't want to be associated with them in any way.
We need our hacky rappers, man. We need them.
They didn't want to be associated with them. But, I mean, that would have been nice going in. It would have been a nice surprise, me going in there to get some fucking gin and beers and
You want me to sign that?
What the fuck?
You knit?
I'd be like, I'd do a shot with them.
Yeah,
I'd be like, it's my birthday.
Is it your birthday?
It's my birthday.
The only question I have is, do you think he still got paid? Because a lot of times for appearances and shit, they should not pay him.
Oh,
well, like, I was referring back to the Azealia Banks thing that's going on right now. She posted, like, ha, I'm still getting paid, because, like, she got pulled from some big headlining festival that she was supposed to play.
Mm.
Because of this whole thing, they pulled her, and people were like, that's what you get, that's what you get. And she was like, I'm still getting paid for it. Like, I have a contract that... Pay or play.
Okay. Yeah, all right. That was a good story. Thank you, Stu. Handshake there for having a good story for Hillsborough.
Hillsborough sucks.
Like, I want to leave.
Turning it over to Mark now. We got a story from Mark being the indie guy.
Uh-oh.
So, Kurt Cobain died, as you guys know.
Oh, shit.
In 93.
Really? 94, yeah.
94.
And you guys are aware, Mark, you're aware of a musician named Juliana Hatfield, right?
Yeah.
I don't know what she actually has a letter written to her from Kurt Cobain that she wants to sell to fans or anyone who wanted to pay for it for $20,000. And I got this story from RTTnews.com, and she's revealed that she's considering selling a letter written to her from the late Kurt Cobain 1 year before his death. And she's considering any offer of at least $20,000 for the handwritten letter, which Cobain wrote after the pair met briefly for the first and only time backstage at a Nirvana show in New York City in 1993.
Where he did her in the bathroom.
Backstage, I said. Or back. You think they
backstage
banged
bathroom.
You think they banged in the bathroom and he wrote her a letter afterwards?
Yeah.
Don't tell Courtney. Yeah,
it was 1992 or
whatever. Here, don't tell Courtney. And she says, as Kurt says, and apologizes for, I don't know if that was a pun or not, but in the letter, there were a lot of people backstage all wanting a little bit of Kurt's attention, wanting to shake his hand, say hello, do some heroin. And the basement dressing room was very small. It was a cramped, noisy scene, which is what she said on her decision to sell the letter. There wasn't really much time or space to focus on having a conversation, but Kurt was very gracious and respectful to me in those brief few minutes, and I was glad to have finally met him. Heffel explains, now this is the part where it's kind of fucked up, I think, but I want to know your opinion, that she feels compelled to sell the letter because of her high living costs in Cambridge, Massachusetts, which she describes as one of the most expensive cities in the United States. So she wants to do that to pay her goddamn rent. Now, she want to sell something that
valuable. She's come move to Hillsboro. It's fucking expensive as shit.
Yeah, okay. So, Mark, what do you, as a Nirvana purist, which I don't want to, I know you're not, but okay. I know you like.
I don't
like,
know what that means.
Like, do you think it's kind of blasphemous or kind of like a shady that she wants to sell the letter just to make a profit?
No, I saw somebody selling one of his foot pedals on TV. They were trying to sell it at the pawn shop.
Yeah, I mean, at this point, I feel like his, like, Kurt Cobain has been mined for everything that he had. You know, like, his fucking childhood home has been up for auction because
his suicide note's probably on sale.
Suicide note, like, anything is, like, you know,
it's up for grabs, basically.
Yeah, like, his notebooks were published and fucking, you know, Courtney Love made, like, the only reason she's still at all relevant is because she's been living off of fucking money that he gave, you know, like, that she got from.
Don't forget People vs. Larry Flint.
Oh, yeah.
Amazing film.
People vs. Larry Flint. And, you know, royalties off the record that he fucking wrote for her or whatever.
Bitterness, but go on. I knew you would pull out this bitterness. I knew you like Nirvana. Go on.
I love Nirvana, yeah. But at the same time, I feel like his legacy is, like, it's so commercialized that I don't blame her for being, like, you know, and it's probably one of those things where she held on to it for, like, sentimental reasons for a long time, but also still always had that thing of, like, after he died, I'm sure there was a point where she was like,
I should sell this.
I got this fucking letter. Like,
that's pretty fucked up, dude. I would never sell something that that fucking bottle that I have on my refrigerator, if he fucking died tomorrow, I know I'd be getting millions because the guy from Bronx Tale is dead.
He never signed another bottle like that.
Every single bottle he sold at that fucking signing got broken, except for mine. And people, the guy from the Ookie Loves movie is dead.
And there's one guy who's got, he's got Dan Aykroyd's Crystal Skullhead vodka bottle sign. He's got Danny DeVito's limoncello bottle sign. He's got a place on his wall waiting for this chest.
Celebrity liquors.
Would I sell it for $20,000? Hell fucking yeah, I'd do it. But I would have some integrity when I did it.
But, yeah, I mean, this whole thing, she's going to sell the letter. I mean, who would buy it? Like, what does it say? What's the significance of it? That's the thing is, like, with any sort of art, per se, like, if we're talking the art world, where different works of art are
it probably are says something like, stay off drugs, sign Kurt Cobain.
That's the thing. It's like, is it a note? Is it it's a full letter that he wrote to her? Does it say, like, I've been dealing with shit? Like, does it allude to anything? Like,
you got a booker.
Is it like, I wrote this song for you? Yeah. Or, like, here's some lyrics I was working on? Like, then I can see it having value. But, like, whatever. Like, are you going to sell a scrap of paper that he wrote something on, like, just because it was him? I'm right. Sure someone will pay for it. But at the same time, like, do I... Yeah, I wish that it was for, like, more just reasons. Like, I'll sell it to the Smithsonian or the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame for $10,000 if they want to pay for it.
Yeah.
But, like, anybody, I'll put it up on eBay. And unless, like,
yeah, I think that's, I think it's kind of messed up, but at the same time,
I want to pay my rent. Yeah. It's a little, I mean, why don't you just downsize? You know? I mean,
move out of Cambridge.
Make another album, I guess. Or,
yeah. People are waiting for your new album, Juliana. Yeah. We're dying for a new Juliana Hatfield album. And you want to sell an fucking letter, but I don't know.
Or if I was her, I'd publish it in my new album, you know, like,
and you're like, force people to buy your record.
You gotta buy the
how do you do that when everyone's streaming nowadays? How would you make them do that?
That's why you got to force them to buy a physical copy.
Oh, that's good. And okay.
That's what they should do. They should just include letters from Kurt Cobain in all albums that are being sold. And all dead musicians. Like,
that will help. Oh, that will help boost the album sales. Yeah, yes.
You know, like
we're on to something here.
Kanye West, if he had a letter from fucking Jim Morrison in Life of Pablo, maybe he would have sold some physical copies of it, exactly. Or actually decided to release a physical copy.
Yeah. Stu, you got anything to add?
No.
All right. Want to move on to my story now?
Yeah.
All right. Last story, you guys, then we'll get to the actual album reviews for the show. So Rolling Stone released their top 100 hip-hop albums of all time. And I will now read them in no particular order.
Onyx.
Number 53.
Oh.
I'm kidding. I'm not going to do all 100 albums.
Started at 53. Are you going to do completely random?
Yeah.
Is that where Onyx hit, 53?
I'm going to do 10 because we all know.
Tribe Called Quest?
You know, I'm sure they're on there. Tribe Called Quest. You got the big ones. You got all the big ones. The top 10 we got here. You guys want to?
Number one, Eminem.
Eminem's on there somewhere with Stan and everything he does. But apparently no Macklemore. Or Vanilla Ice.
It's scandalous.
I know.
No Vanilla Ice.
No.
Oh, come on.
No Ski-Lo.
I heard he's making a big comeback.
Where's Ski-Lo? I wish. Where's Ski-Lo? But all right. Top 10 albums out of the 100. I'm going to do the top 10 from RollingStone.com. Number 10, Eric B. and Rakim, Paid in Full. Great song from the album Paid in Full. Obviously, my white friends don't want to say anything. Number 9.
I don't know what the cover looks like.
Number nine, that's the album with Ain't No Joke and everything like that. Number nine is Straight Outta Compton, obviously.
Yeah.
On the list based on the movie, I think, but at the same time,
okay.
a great song.
Chronic.
Number eight, Juicy from Notorious B.I.G.
Not Chronic.
Which samples...
Wait, these are songs?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. All
right. This samples that song, Juicy Fruit, which I didn't know at the time as a kid. So whenever I hear that song on like the older like radio stations my parents listen to, I'm like, oh shit, they're playing Biggie on this, and it's not. It's just that song. Great song, but
you had to print out, and you got a he's got a big ass picture,
yeah,
of each rapper.
You want to do? Do you see the picture? You want to say the picture since you're such a hip hop head?
You wasted a shit ton of ink.
Who's that?
Is that Jay-Z? All
right, number seven is Public Enemy, Fight the Power. Fight the Power.
I can't see. Want
to sing a lyric to us, too? Mark. Lyric to Fight the Power. I know there's some black in you.
Fight the power.
You gotta
fight the power.
I'm trying to.
B. Elvis was a hero to most, but he never meant shit to me. God damn it! People don't like fucking
bass. How low can you go?
Not that song.
No, that's the only one.
Number six is a song that Stu's been singing over and over again. Dr. Dre and Snoop Doggy Dogg is what he was called at the time. Nothing but a G thing, baby. Yeah. Too low down. G's Chronic going crazy. There. Death Row is the label that
pays me.
Mark, you have to jump in on one of these songs, man.
I knew that one.
All right. I was just drinking a drink at the time.
He was drinking his Windex.
Drinking my blue Windex.
Number five, Ghetto Boys. Mind Playing Tricks on Me. Remember that song?
No.
You guys know the gangster song, though. Damn,
is Ghetto Boys with
nah.
Ill Bill?
Little the midget. What's his name? I can't remember his name. Shit. Scarface, Bushwick Bill.
Bushwick Bill.
Yes, and
sounds like a wrestler.
Scarface, Bushwick Bill, Bushwick. And Willie D. The rap group from Houston, Texas, and they had that. They were the precursors of basically what would you call that? Like gangster rap before. Dr. Dre really blew
never
up.
Heard of him.
All right,
and that's getting up there too. That's
number
pretty
four
up there.
Is Run DMC, Sucker MCs. I don't think that's the best song by them, but what do you guys think?
I don't know. They're very holy.
Yeah, but I wouldn't have put that song number four.
Yeah,
I like them, but yeah, that's probably
that
not
Christmas
a
song.
Oh, that Christmas
and Hollis is your shit.
Yeah,
where's Christmas and Hollis? Rolling Stone, wrong song. I'm beginning to see on the list they're going with like old school and new school rap. So I wanted to get I'll give my opinion on what I think of this whole list.
Run DMC, Jam Master J. Run.
R.I.P. Jam Master J. Number three, African Bambaataa, Planet Rock.
Oh, there we go. That's the guy. Remember the one podcast we had? I was like, remember the guy with the UFOs and they like they like come out of the water and come from the center of the earth.
I thought you were talking about Palm and Funkadelic at first. Yeah.
And you're like, who? And you're like, George Clinton? I'm like, not George Clinton. I'm like, I can't remember. It was like Africa or something. And you still didn't get it after that.
This is the group that had that rock, Planet Rock.
Yeah, I know that song. Yeah, I love African Bambaataa. Yeah. So, now that's like, that's borderline hip-hop electro.
Right.
Yeah.
What do you think of this list that's being number three?
I don't know. This is one of those things now, though. We're getting back into the 50 Cent territory, because isn't African Bambaataa now, like, on child molestation charges?
What? I didn't even know that.
Sure.
Really?
What?
Yeah,
let me see if that's
written anywhere. Should he be included in this list, because now... Yeah.
No, I didn't know that.
I don't know if they'll mention it in there. Like, this song is the best, and he was fucking some kids.
Well, Rick Rubin said it's one of the most influential songs of everything, but he didn't say that, oh, by the way, he touched kids.
That was Paul Rubens.
Oh, was that the song Planet Rock?
Rick Rubin said
that. Was that the song, though, that they picked? Paul,
that's a good joke.
Planet Rock?
Yeah.
All right.
You like that song on the list? Number three.
Yeah.
So if you like that song that much, what do you think is better than that?
Oh. I don't know, maybe some Puffy?
Puffy? All right, you think All About the Benjamins number two?
Sean Combs? He should be in there.
It's All About the Benjamins number two. No, it's Rapper's Delight by Sugar Hill Gang.
Okay, all right, that's understandable.
Which is like
they took somebody that knew old school rap and new school rap and like kind of like did a favor to.
But there's no Drake on there, though. There's no Drake on it.
They're more 100. Legendary.
There's no Drake on the top 100 or. Future or fucking Fetty Wap.
Well, yeah.
Fetty Wap, number one.
Exactly, I hear you.
Fetty Wap, number one.
So, yeah, Rappers Delight, which is like, you know, the 12-minute song that everyone quotes, and even that old lady from the Wedding Singer movie, you know, that's what made that song big again. So if that's number two, which I thought would be the number one song, which I thought, like, oh, this list is very hacky, but they put that number two. So I'm like, what could possibly be the number one song? You guys want to guess?
Brick by Ben Folds 5.
Stu? You're still going with what song you said?
Broken Glass.
No, you said the...
Who was that that did that? Broken Glass everywhere. Cool Keith? Is that Cool Keith?
He got it. He got
it. Is it really?
The Message is number one. Grandmaster Flash. And say the lyrics again. Broken Glass everywhere.
Broken Glass everywhere.
You're pissing in their things and they just don't care.
Yeah.
How do you, I
called it. Nice.
Good job. High five this dude. A little fist pump, too. We'll bump butts later. The thing I like about that is I really think it's not too hacky to put that song number one, because that really is a really monumental song, because it's not the party song as the previous one of the Rapper's Delight, but this is more like a... Like, the song's called The Message. It's a really intricate, deep song about hip-hop. I like hip-hop that has, like, meaning. And that's not so much worried about, like, having good beats or, like, you know, punchlines. That's what I'm looking for.
I don't know if I know this song.
Really?
Yeah.
Don't push me, because I'm close to the edge.
I'm trying not to lose my head.
You were kind of right, because Puffy did sample this song with his...
Okay.
I was going to say, yeah, you can...
You did.
I know that.
It's like a jungle sometimes. Maybe you want to keep going under. But fuck Puffy.
Just so I was right. African Bambaataa denies sexually assaulting.
That's horrible.
Denies accusations. He sexually assaulted boys in the 80s. So he's denying it, but apparently there's some allegations.
He might be the Gary Glitter of our hip hop community. But let us know what you guys think of this list from the comments, or send us an email at AngieHabitRadio.
With Jared of Subway.
AngieHabitRadio@gmail.com. And with that, that ends all the bullshit of what we do.
Is it true that, like, child molestation comes in threes, like death?
I don't know. If you touch one kid, how can you stop?
Because there's the dad from Seventh Heaven. There's Jared Fogle.
And that took a while, though. It's got to be, like, a week later, like okay, death, you know? It can't be, like, years later.
The sad truth is, I'm sure it happens every day.
Sad but true. Kids get touched all the time. Let's get a moment of silence of touching kids.
Ew, you can't make sounds. What are you doing? You ruined it.
It was delicious. Are you really drinking Windex, Mark? What is that? It's blue. Mark has blue stuff in like a water bottle.
No, it's there's those water.
Oh, okay.
You know, a little squeezy bottle. It's got some energy shit in there, so it gives you a little boost.
I feel the energy coming from you. It's resonating all over your skin.
Hash oil beverage,
or is it just hot in this room?
Yeah, I wish. No, this is like I'll drink this in the morning usually, like just to like. Clear my head up.
All right.
Get my head straight. All right. We're going to take some shots and we're going to do some reviews now. The trick is, you guys,
boom.
We get to the level when we're good and drunk, so you get our full unadulterated opinion of these albums.
If these podcasts go any longer, we need a pee bucket.
Yeah, right.
Oh, you want to take a leak while I do my introduction?
Oh, sure.
All right. Stu will be right back after these messages. After these messages, we'll be right back. I like how look that up, kids. That's when you guys used to have Saturday morning cartoons. So we're gonna start with the Beyonce, her album Lemonade. I should have waited. That's why I waited till he goes to the pee, because if I said Lemonade, he would have had to pee right now. Her album Lemonade is her sixth album from the R&B mogul. And she released this as a surprise on April 23rd on Tidal to accompany her HBO special that aired the same night. And this is a conceptual album, possibly about relationships, mistrust, and infidelity issues. And it says, led the public to think it's about Jay-Z, and it fucking had the whole internet exploding about what this whole album's about and all these questions, things like that. Now, Lemonade has quite a few producers, such as Just Blaze, Hit-Boy, and Diplo.
Somebody say Lemonade.
And features guest artists for each one of us, actually.
Yeah, totally.
I thought it's got Kendrick Lamar for me. It's got Jack White for Mark. And it's got James Blake for Stu.
Who's James Blake?
You're not a James Blake fan?
Nah, I don't know who that is.
Yeah, you think you know somebody. All right. So we are going to break down most of the tracks musically and lyrically, most of them, not all of them, to attempt to find the true depth of this release.
Oh, I'm going to take a nap.
What I thought was interesting is that she released this before her follow-up albums, the double album, Milk.
What? She has a new album coming out?
Oh, yeah. There's Milk, and now there's Lemonade.
Oh. First, I'm like, wait, what? Is the first going to be the next one?
Around the corner.
Yeah.
I'm not going to blow up your spot that you thought of that joke like 2 weeks ago, but okay.
I literally just thought of it 2 minutes ago, and then I waited
When I came back from the bathroom and said, somebody say Lemonade?
Yeah, nice. So the first song is called Pray You Catch Me, which is like a quiet piano, like R&B introduction to Beyonce's like cheating suspicions. And then like you got the violin fade out after that song, and then the next song that comes on, which is called... Hold Up, and it's got like the Hot 97, like, you know, the line, you know, over and over again.
Yeah, but
and then she's fucking pissed on that song. That's what I like. She's like, I'm going to fuck a bitch up. I'm like, all right, I like this song.
Is that like sample Enya? It was very Enya.
Who would know like that?
Sail Away.
Oh, you know Enya?
Sail away, sail away, sail away.
Is that how it goes?
Yeah, you don't know
her? I don't know Enya. I know who she is, but I don't know any of her songs. Yeah. I thought she was too easy listening for me. What I thought about Hold Up, the second song, is like I like the aggressiveness, and at the same time it's like a mellow like reggae song, so I dug it. Mm-hmm. Like, do you guys actually have an opinion on that song? Or
Don't ask me.
Okay, Mark, do you have an opinion on that song?
Well, yeah, I mean, the first, I really like the opening of it. I like the opening of the album, and then
she was
the
like,
second
huh?
track. Yeah.
Huh? Yeah, okay.
All right, going into this with no knowledge of what I would expect from a Beyonce album,
because mm-hmm.
I've only really known, like, Who Run the World, Girls, Single Ladies, Drunk in Love.
And the Destiny Child stuff.
There was a whole lot of pausing.
Yeah.
Why was there a whole lot of pausing and atmospheric, like, it'd be like,
Whoosh. Oh, when a song ends for the next song?
And then she'd be like,
yeah.
I'm a bitch.
She'd hear me again, you die.
Yeah, next song. Yeah. It was
Mark, what did you, what, like the first two songs you were kind of like with? It. I want to actually know what Mark thinks of the first song, the Jack White song. Which was called Don't Hurt Yourself. And it's got him, Jack White, singing the hook. What'd you think of that song?
I didn't know going into it that he was going to be on this album.
Yeah, me neither.
And, like, at the, it wasn't until the so I listened to this record, like, 2.5 times.
Mm.
The first time, I was like, it was the very end of the song, and I was like, I think it's Jack White on this song.
Yeah.
And then listening to it again, I'm like, oh, yeah, it's definitely, like.
Yeah.
I'll listen to it half a time.
Spoiler alert.
But yeah, it's a I like it, and at the same time, I feel like,
yeah. Well, the thing I like that
it's not a great song, but it's at least got some good stuff to it.
The drumming gets heavy, like for Beyonce anyway. What for a person that's heard her older stuff, I thought like this was like her actually like trying different things. So I thought it was a risky thing. At the same time, with Jack White doing the hook, it had like kind of an R&B feel to it. So I wasn't like this is horrible, but I was like, all right, this is kind of fair. I think it's a fair song. You don't want me to tell you, ask your opinions too, so we'll move on to the single, which is called Sorry. It's got like an electro pop sound with like a little bit of a trap
that's
beat.
That's a fucking single.
Sorry, yeah, it is.
I don't know music.
I didn't like that song either when I heard it. I'm really like, this song sucks, but like this song, the reason I'm asking about this song is she's dismissing like her excuse of a man on this song. And the song also features, like, the lyric that everyone's been talking about when she's, like, talking about a song that suck her balls. And the infamous line when she says, call Becky with the good hair, which has the whole fucking internet exploding. Like, who is Becky with the good hair? Is it Rachel Ray? Is it Rachel Ross? Rachel Roy? Who is it about? Or is it about some other white hoe? Who's the Becky with the good hair? Obviously, I think it's about a white girl because the name's Becky. And usually when black women talk about that girl's got good hair or they're with like an attitude, they're talking about like a white girl because her hair is stringy and everything like that. And obviously she might be talking about JC's fucking a white girl. So what do you think of that song, you guys?
I didn't like that one.
You didn't like it based on...
I don't like the repeat, I'm sorry.
I ain't sorry.
It's like...
I ain't sorry.
I don't like it.
Yeah, I didn't like that song either. All right. I agree with you. But yeah, did you know about the whole thing?
Sucking my balls, didn't like it either. I was like, because, all right, going into this, like, I'm thinking, all right, Beyonce is like, sure, she's a pop star, but she, like, I feel like there's this air, there's like a thought that she's like graceful in a way.
Yeah.
Like, she has an air of like, you know, she's like Michelle Obama or something.
The Michelle Obama of rap, R&B,
I don't
yes.
think she realizes that you're not really supposed to get your balls sucked because it kind of tickles when you suck on them. It's more of a
especially if you're a girl.
It's more of like a humming and like a licking type thing. And they just have to be in the mouth. I mean, that's all right.
Yeah.
But no actual sucking on the balls.
It's not a pacifier, damn it.
Speak for yourself.
Yeah, lick the balls.
They're a little too sensitive for that. Yeah.
My balls.
Did she say lick?
She said sucking my balls. Suck my balls, she said to somebody. The thing I have about the you have no opinion of this? You have no opinion of the song?
No.
Sorry,
I hated it all.
Okay. So the thing
passion.
The thing I want to say about this at that point.
You wasted my time.
The thing I had I agree with Stu. At that point, I'm like, I'm not into this album lyrically for two reasons. One, I'm not 100% sure that this album is about like her. Or it's like she's like playing a character, you know? Mm-hmm. And two, I was like
Sasha Fierce Part 2.
Yeah, Beyonce writes like My Man Ain't Shit songs all the time. So back when she wrote that song, All Your Stuff's to the Left, why weren't people saying like is that about Jay-Z? No one said shit about that until now. So why is it different now as opposed to back then? So I'm like I'm like what's Stu at this point? I'm like, I'm not really feeling this album I think it's all a publicity stunt. Get us to buy it or go on a title or like that.
They definitely want you to sign up for title.
Yeah, until I heard 6 Inch that features The Weeknd. It's got like that R&B like alternative thing that people are doing nowadays.
It's Jay-Z and Beyonce. Of course, they want to release it exclusively on title.
Yeah, But that song, Six Inch, I like that song because it's like got that Isaac Hayes sample, which I fucking thought was beautifully intertwined into the song. I think Wu-Tang did that on their album, the W, the Isaac Hayes song that they sampled on that song. And they got The Weeknd on there. He did a good job on that song. And then, goddamn, I know you guys are going to be shit on this. You're going to be shit. I don't care. But that Daddy's Lesson song, that country western song, I fucking love that shit. The New Orleans brass section comes in. The yeehaws are coming in. I'm like, dude, this song is great. I mean, I would never have pictured liking a country western song from Beyonce. But I was like, this song is amazing.
I don't like country western or Beyonce.
I don't either.
So I'm not going to like, I didn't like anything about it.
I love that song, man. Why did you like that song?
No, it's fucking horrible.
You know what? Fuck you, Stu.
Dude, this
Mark, back me up,
this
man.
One is a total banishment.
No, I didn't like that
You didn't
song.
Like that song? Why?
No. As much as some of the rest of the album, I
she really took a chance on that song. I thought it was great.
Here's okay. My overall thing with the album as a whole is that I feel like there's no consistent theme to it. There's a song that's like a small little piano ballad, then there's a song that's got Jack White on it, then there's a song where it's like a fucking, you know, ghetto-ish, like, I ain't sorry, bitch. You know, fuck you, yeah. Suck on my balls. And then, like, and then there's, yeah, then there's a country song. Then there's the one that sounds like, you know, it samples some old, like, that Freedom song, whatever that's called.
Yeah,
know.
Freedom, yeah. With Kendrick Lamar, which I'll get to in a second, yeah. But go on.
And different songs, I feel like, it just, on the, like, for such an album that all I had heard about was like, oh my God, it's so controversial. It's all about her fucking, you know, relationship with Jay-Z. I felt like there was a lot of just, like, filler shit. Like, that I Ain't Sorry song, I felt like it was filler. This song, I felt like, while, like, catchy, I didn't like it. I just felt like, why is she doing a country song? Like, because it's just, to me, it's like, all right, well, she's trying to appeal to people that are going to buy the album, but at the same time, like, I didn't see how it fits in. Like, I still don't know what Lemonade is. I don't
I'll
know
tell
what
you guys in a second,
means.
But go
like,
on. She says that, she says it at the end of the album, but go on. You're first of all, you're not listening to lyrics because I said five songs
she's
in.
She's getting it together with Miley Cyrus.
I said five songs in. She's talking too much about this, like, fuck my man. He's not doing right. It's a theme. It's like, you know.
Well, yeah.
It's I'm a not, theme
yeah,
going
there's
on.
There's a theme, but I feel like it's a theme, but still trying to just like why do a fucking country song?
Because and then, at that point, she's saying like, all right, now I'm talking about the girl. With six inch heels is about like a prostitute or like a promiscuous woman with six inch heels, and it's like, all right, now this part of this album is about the slutty girl, whatever, that probably took my man. I'm pissed about that, but my daddy has taught me how to be a strong woman and everything like that, and that's the lyrics about that song. I like that because it's a very catchy country song. I don't want to get into the lyrics too much because I don't remember everything she's saying, but that's what the song's about. Like, you know, her father telling her about his lifestyle of being like a man, like a Rolling Stone, like the song by the Temptations. And then that's how her dad lives his life. And he's at the same time saying, don't be like me. At the same time, there's guys like that out there. Watch out for them. Tying into the first six or seven tracks before that.
Well, yeah. Okay. I understand how it ties into the theme that all the songs are about infidelity, whatever. But it's just like,
and then it gets to the whole Black Pride and the women's rights thing with the Freedom song. And then go ahead, Mark.
I feel like that song should have been like, it's like perfect for like the next Quentin Tarantino trailer.
Okay, like, Freedom.
Yeah.
I thought that song was like very motivational and like this got like I thought you liked it because I remember you singing like the Kendrick Lamar first album song.
Yeah,
and it's the same theme, like a gospel song. And I don't know if you like the Kendrick Lamar song based on the fact that it's a gospel song or if you like the lyrics, but...
You mean a Kanye.
Yeah, a Kanye song. Mm-hmm. I thought you liked that song for the same reason.
I do like that song. I mean,
Freedom, I'm talking about. Yeah.
I mean, I'm just saying that country song I didn't like.
Okay. But well, Freedom,
I
mean, you liked
it. I don't have terrible feelings on the rest of the
okay.
CD.
Okay, so
except
at that point it picks up...
It's a fucking 12-song CD with at least... A couple, like two or three, which the country song to me is a filler track. I mean, that's just
you're hurting my feelings, man. I thought we would love that song.
I don't know what the
fuck.
I don't know what's
called.
Oh,
you dwelling on it? Let it go.
Okay,
it
I'll let
sucked.
It go.
Sucked.
But number nine,
you liked it.
Track number nine, whatever that is, It's she's not on it. It's like a minute and a half of some other dude like.
Oh, that's you. That's you, man. Stu, James Blake. What do you think of that song?
With it's nothing. Great. It's not a song.
It's an interlude.
It's a little guy fucking mumbling. And
yeah,
like,
yeah, I hear you. I hear you.
Oh, it was some of the atmospheric droning shit.
It's garbage. Yeah.
It's an interlude. Yeah, yeah. So you didn't like that?
Yeah, garbage.
But he's in the beginning. There's tons of that. The first song, in a way. He produced the first song, and he's actually on the interlude. And I guess you didn't actually like that song, Stu. But
no,
after that song is Freedom, right?
Yeah,
horrible.
So Freedom, I like because Kendrick Lamar fucking kills on that song as always.
Oh yeah, I dig it.
He puts a cherry on that fucking banger, and the last song Formation, which he did at the Super Bowl, it's got like that bouncy like bing 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 the plucking strings. I thought it's definitely a fucking ladies' anthem song. And she says in the lyrics that if you hit it right, she'll take you to Red Lobster. So I'm fucking sold. Like, if that's all you got to do to win Beyonce's heart, I'm there. Because I love Red Lobster. I guess it's only safe to say I should go first before you guys trash the shit out of this album.
Yeah, because Red Lobster sucks too.
For the most part, I like the project and a few likable tracks. I think this was better than her last album, the self-titled album that she did a couple years ago in 2013. Because I think that album is like that like atmospheric like dark hip-hop trend that Kanye West was starting with his album like Yeezus. And I had my doubts.
Yeezus.
I had my doubts about this album being about Jay-Z until, because like, I'm thinking to myself, like I'm like, listen, like why would Jay-Z release the album on his record label if it's trashing him? Until I found out that Beyonce actually co-owns Tidal. So maybe it is about him. And I must admit, the reggae songs remind me a bit of Rihanna. But I'd be lying if I didn't say I didn't like
it. I wouldn't even call that reggae.
The song fucking, the second to last song, All Night, that's like a roots reggae song. You cannot deny that's like a reggae song. So you don't know what you're talking about. Do not fuck with me.
It's fucking garbage.
Aside from the overdone heartbreak theme, I think that one was pretty good, so I'm going to say...
She stole it.
I want to say...
She dubbed that dub reggae.
The second last song?
Yeah, she ain't Jamaican. She stole it.
Okay. You're saying you can't be Jamaican and do reggae?
No, it's a sound.
It's a sound. So I say you can buy this album. Mark, let's go to you. What do you think of this album?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I think there's some filler tracks on it. But overall, I feel like it's not bad. Like the thing I've always said is like things I like most about music is just if it's like authentic feeling to me, and I feel like a lot of this comes across authentic and like
yeah,
you know. Regardless, I mean, there's lots of shit. I mean, I just don't pay attention to music news about Beyonce in general. Prior to listening to this, I had never watched the fucking Cop Car in the Lake video. I didn't watch her fucking halftime performance. I don't know. I didn't watch the short film of whatever the fuck she puts out.
Oh, you're the type of guy that turns a channel during the Super Bowl halftime show and turns back during the game?
I'm the kind of guy who doesn't watch the Super Bowl in general. Whatever.
All right.
But, I mean, overall...
He's busy watching a movie a day.
Yeah, I don't have time to watch fucking football.
Are you kidding me?
But, yeah, I mean, it's just... it's whatever. It's good. I'd say download it. That's my rating.
All right.
Overall, I ended up liking it more than I thought I would. And that's always, like, a positive thing.
That's all that matters to me. You at least gave it higher than a skip this. I appreciate that, Mark. Yeah, I'm surprised. Like, I'm not surprised, but I'm glad. I was like, he was going to, when I listened to this album, I'm like, I was surprised with the Kanye West album he did a few weeks back of liking it that much. But when I heard this album, I'm like, all right, it's equal with her being trying new things. I'm like, I would expect Mark to at least tolerate this record, and you did. Thank you so much, Snarky.
Well, that's the thing I like about it, is that you can tell that, and granted, I don't think that she should have done a country song. I don't understand why she's, like, jumping genres throughout this album. It's kind of weird, because if it's about breakup, then make
it's an experimental album,
it's experimental.
I think it is.
I appreciate, you know, like, some stuff is just...
I think the experiment went wrong.
All right, go ahead.
Like, she grew, like, mutant arms, and, like, her vagina flipped inside out,
for
and, like,
someone,
grew,
you know,
teeth.
It's the thing, it's the reason I like Life of Pablo a lot, because to me it's like, for someone who's so high in the spotlight, it's hard for them to reinvent themselves and have it come across that, and to keep fans, you know, like, it's,
yeah,
you can't always pull it off, and I think that it's something that she's sort of woven into what who she is now, as opposed to just being this gospel-y, belting it out singer. She's also now doing somewhat interesting things, you know?
And maybe before you say your thing, Stu, if this is actually about the relationship, she's actually opening herself up to the infidelity that her husband's doing and the whole, like, I still gotta be a strong woman and a strong black person at the same time. Maybe it is really personal and meaning deep things. Go ahead.
Fucking shit. It's fucking shit. I didn't like it. Sorry.
Okay. All right.
You can give it a...
I ain't sorry.
You can get a full banishment from me.
You're saying fuck this album?
Yeah, and burn it. Dude, I'd put her on a freaking stick and burn her.
All right.
Burn!
Uh-oh, you're gonna get some backlash from that.
Yeah, I know. Send all your hate mail to Stu. Hold on
but
a second.
But I like Jay-Z.
He's not on the album, but you like him?
Yeah, I like Jay-Z.
Oh, you're biased. All right. You're a biased guy.
You mean that you like Chuck D, right?
Yeah, you're only mad because he's hating on your boy. All right. So make sure you send all your hate mail to Stu when you send emails to njhybridradio@gmail.com and make sure you title it "Stu, you're a fucking dick. You don't know what you're talking about." And then write the email.
You can also send Stu, you're right. Jarrell, shut the fuck up.
I'm sure I'll get plenty of
those. To www.njhybridradio. Oh, wait. No, that's not the email. njhybridradio@gmail.com.
Yes. And if you have an opinion about this album, tell us in the comments section. And as we get the email address, njhybridradio.com. njhybridradio@gmail.com. Send us your opinions and actually tell us what you would rate this album. If you liked it or hated it, or if you agree with Stu and say it's that horrible, or if you want to say your opinion about the meaning of the record and everything like that, we'd like to know your opinion.
Dude, I hardly gave it a chance. Sorry. Sorry.
That's fair. You're finally admitting the truth, motherfucker.
And I've probably been closer to Jay-Z than any of you.
Oh, you're that close with him? You're tight? My fingers are together.
I went to Daddy's house. The studio in Manhattan? No, Daddy's house?
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Whose house?
Yeah,
Daddy's house.
I had a friend that worked there.
Okay. Oh, all right. So next we're going to go to Drake. Before we do that, as you know, you might not know, me and Mark are big SNL fans, and he hosted and performed last night on SNL. What'd you think of his second time hosting the show, Mark?
Didn't see it yet.
All right.
Yesterday, I watched the previous week's, and I haven't had a chance to watch last night's yet.
How could you watch? Why wouldn't you just skip a week?
Of what?
He wouldn't understand what's going on.
It was like Saturday Night Live was on. You're like, oh, but I missed last week's. I'll watch last
week's. You don't want to forget the plot. No. He wants to know what's going on.
The one that's live.
I don't have TV. Like, I don't have cable. I don't watch TV live. So everything's, if it comes up on Hulu or whatever. Now, when certain things come up, and like, okay, SNL is one of the shows that I watch, you know, consistently.
Goddamn, he's talking, Lil Jon. I'm sorry, Mark. He's rude. As you guys can hear out there, our mascot is very rude and interrupts stories every time they're getting to the good part. Please, after we finish these shots, Mark, go on with your intricate story.
Short story, longer.
Why you pass me your beer?
No, I'm putting it right there, out the way.
All right.
Anyway, we watched it.
Get out the way.
Now, I think the reason Mark watched SNL in order is to follow the plot.
Yeah, pretty much. I don't know what's going on with Drunk Uncle.
Exactly. Because you missed our boy Jay Farrow did another weekend update with impressions, this time of hip-hop rappers.
Last night?
Yeah.
Oh, well, I'm still going to see it.
Okay.
I mean, it's the next day.
Yeah. You gotta avoid Facebook for a long time, though. Facebook is putting, like, fucking spoilers of, like, who was a surprise guest. You ever notice that on your Facebook wall? They put surprise guests who were on there, and they also post like actual like sketches, full sketches on Facebook. I guess you don't subscribe. You're not friends with Saturday Night Live on Facebook. All right, I don't know. I guess that's why you do that. Yeah. I think his appearance was not as great as the first one, but he did a good job on some sketches, and some sketches were just not funny. And it's not his fault. Like, you're in a sketch, you just do the best you can, and that's the way it goes. But on to Drake. How is Drake actually with albums? Let's find out with that. And if you don't know who Drake is, he's a Canadian singer, rapper, and formerly Jimmy Brooks from the TV show Degrassi. And he rose to fame with his debut EP, So Far Gone, in 2009. Then he went and signed to Cash Money Records and joined Lil Wayne's posse, Young Money. Young Moolah, baby!
And he's a Canadian.
Yeah, Canadian rapper. Like, he's not as good as Snow, but he's getting there.
He used to build big, giant snow forts when he was a kid.
Mm-hmm. The fuck? Why would you ruin that joke?
And those snow forts last almost the whole year?
Damn, he killed that shit. I'm sorry, you guys out there. Obviously, Stu's not a fan of Informer. And his Drake's first full-length album, Thank Me Later, went platinum, and in each album after, doubled the sales of the previous one. And all the releases that he's put out contain highly successful singles that apparently Mark has never heard before, except for maybe two songs.
I mean, I might have heard stuff, I just don't know it. Like, and working at a CD store too. Like, I know where the Drake section is.
I know. And they're like, "What's the best album, Drake of Drake?" When you go to the section, like, I don't know. Like, I guess Take that Care one. Pretty good. So you do know.
I know the titles. I know what the covers look like, and I know that he exists as a person. And he used to be on Degrassi. What his songs are.
Some say Take Care is his opus, so you knew that. Yeah,
never know.
Now 2015.
Not judging by this one, say this one definitely is not his opus.
2015 was a great year for Drake, and this is why. Both his mixtapes, If You're Reading This, It's Too Late, and What a Time to Be Alive, which features Future, went platinum, and then his song Hotline Bling was overplayed on all the radio stations and went viral, being subjected to hundreds of memes. And he fucking bodied rapper Meek Mill on a diss track back to back. And this album, Views, is his fourth full length album and was released on his own label, OVO Sound. Now, he starts the album off with the R&B crooner style thing that he does with the 70s influential track called Keep the Family Close. And I think this is what Drake always does, so I'm kind of like, eh, whatever. Next song's called Nine. It's got like a really shitty like drum beat. I didn't like that song. And then I think the album actually like picks up on track 3, which is called You With Me. Samples a couple of DMX songs with like a chilled out beat at the same time. Now you're saying to yourself out there, how can you have a chilled out beat with DMX lyrics at the same time? Basically, he just says what you want from a nigga, and then the song begins, and he just said that over and over. And it's got like the intro, and it's got like the kind of beat from another song from DMX, which I can't remember right now. And even though Drake has a laid back flow on here, it matches perfectly with the instrumentation. So I like that song. And then another three songs I like, which is called Feel No Ways, got the old school vibe. And I know, Stu, I want to ask you this. The song Feel No Ways got like the break beats that remind me a lot of like the New York hip hop scene in the 80s. And I know you're really into like the dancing stuff, and I know that goes way back to like the break dancing.
It'd bring the breaks. Yeah. It'd bring the breaks back.
Like when the beat kicks in, you know that breaking stuff. I like that song. Do you like that song, Stu?
Yeah, you know what? I didn't give it that much of a chance.
What do you mean by that?
I didn't like what I was hearing.
Am I a clown? No, what do you mean?
I mean, we're even listening to it in the car. I mean, I don't like it that much.
Put your mic down, dude.
My mic was down. You should have noticed it was down.
I wasn't looking at you.
Before you addressed me and I had to pick it back up because I was like, Drake, I'm going to put my mic down.
Before we go on, you guys, let me just say again, this is the third time Stu has failed me. Send all your hate mail to Stu about why he's not listening to full albums or whatever.
No, because I already had a fucking opinion of what I heard, and I couldn't fucking deal with it. I was like, this is enough. I can't listen to any more of this crap, and I didn't want to listen to it.
You're getting the mail, man. I can feel it.
I'm waiting for the hate, man.
All right.
I'm waiting for the hate, man. I want to hear them try to persuade me to the light side. Because right now, I'm killing some Drake.
All
right.
So
with red lightsabers.
Stu, you can still give your opinion at the end. But let me guys like know out there, it's not valid whatsoever. Song hype, Mark.
Mm-hmm.
It's got kind of like a future vibe on it because it's got like the heavy trap beat. And Drake has like a little twist on what he does with his vocals. And I thought would have been good with the previous like mixtape, which I don't think you've heard it, but whatever. I'm not a trap fan, but I thought it was not too bad, and it wasn't too long at the same time. So we're going about like 6 songs in. What was your opinion at that point?
Kill me.
You made it through the whole thing?
I listened to all fucking 20 songs, okay. This fucking long ass record of the same fucking thing over and over again.
Okay.
See, I try to get through the whole thing.
Go in,
fucking
man.
Bullshit. This
Go.
Guy, it's the same thing over and over again. The same talk about the same girl, probably the same problems with like terrible lyrics. I got too many chains. They call me Chaining Tatum. Like, fuck you, fuck you. Fuck
you remember that line? I totally forgot about that shit.
Are you kidding me? Like all the terrible lines in this fucking song. Piss me off. The only thing that I like, all right, because here's the thing, right? So I know what the album cover looks like. It's like a, you know, a gray sky with like a, I don't know, some kind
from
of,
wherever he lives,
whatever,
in
Toronto Tower, Toronto, yeah, whatever. Yeah. So like, and then and in between every song, there's like wind noises, and it's like, you know, oh, like it's lonely at the top is what I get. This whole album is supposed to be about like my fucking girl decided to choose not me. Because I wanted to fucking, I didn't want to smoke weed every day with her or something. Uh-huh. All my boys, I can't talk to my friends. You know, I can't, and like that's like a lot of songs, it's like the same kind of crap. You know, it's like, and yeah, it's just, to me, this whole record, it's like his flow is like boring. Mm. The way he says things is stupid. The words he chooses are terrible. I didn't like any of it for the most part. There's moments here and there where I was like, this isn't as bad as that last thing I heard. It's
yeah,
all,
I,
but
I feel
overall,
you on that. Yeah, I
overall,
feel the same
I just, way. I didn't enjoy almost any of it.
That's okay. Like the educated version of what I was going to say.
Yeah, but the thing I want to say, like you guys hated like most of it, but there were points when he goes for like a more like dancey stuff, like the
what's
single
that's
the single called what's on the radio called One Dance. It's like a dance hall tune, and it's got like, I thought it was a good song with like the girl whose name was like Kala, who had singing during the piano part. I thought the song was good, and the song Still Here has like a good drop beat at the end, and then the song Faithful, I want to tell you guys out there, features rapper Pimp C. And it's a big deal because he's been dead since 2007.
What?
And he hasn't. Let me tell you guys right now. He doesn't say much in the song. He's been dead for a long time, but he's on the song. I like the song Pop Style, which reminds me a lot of the Big Sean song Blessings. And I feel like I'm alone for knowing what that song is in this room right now.
Blessings on Blessings on Blessings.
Yeah. All right. So that song, Pop Styles, reminds me of that with the whole atmospheric like vibe. And, but it's got like the video game like sounds to it, beats. I thought that was good. I want to let's ask you the opinion because I know what you're going to say, Stu. This song called Too Good features Rihanna. And when they put Drake and Rihanna together, it's like a big deal. Now, what'd you think of that
it's
song?
It's like a two-headed monster.
Yeah, exactly. It's like, I thought that song was like under par for a Drake Rihanna collabo, and I thought Rihanna was like totally underused on that song.
Yeah, it's like, oh hey, it's Rihanna.
Yeah,
like it's and the song still sucks. Like I don't know, you know, I listened to it once, and then I listened to like I skipped through it just to remind myself while I was on the way here, and I was like, Yeah, all this, to me, it just all sounds the same. I don't understand how any of this would be considered popular music. I mean, yeah. I really don't even understand why Hotline Bling is, like, a hit song.
Yeah, and it's the last song on here. And we're not going to really, like, review that song because I know you guys heard this song so many times for us to bother. But I think this album is so fucking average.
Yeah.
Definitely. You know, it's like, my complaints are this. There are too many stagnant tracks. There are too many times when tracks end too soon that songs I actually like. But most of all, there are too many goddamn tracks.
Yeah, it's long as fuck.
Yeah, it's like, you could have cut 6 or 7 songs out this album.
Quality, not quantity.
Yeah, it would have been a solid record if they cut like 6 or 7 songs out.
Nobody wants quantity of music. Yeah, I want tons of shitty music. Yeah. I really want tons of shitty music. Look how much shitty music I have.
I was 20 fucking songs, Drake. 20 goddamn songs. And all the lyrics are is what Mark said, talking about past relationships and my hometown. That's it. And it's like the 4th album. Like, I'm like, how many fucking girlfriends do you have?
Yeah.
It's all this guy talks about. Or are you talking about the same girl like that many times? It's like, goddamn. Who cares? But he did say on one track on this album that he makes his money on reminiscing. So it's like, what can I say? Like, if that's all you make money on, get your money, motherfucker. Like, light-skinned guy getting paid. What can I say?
I'm trying to remember what the other... There was one other really terrible lyric that I can't remember.
There's so many to remember. There's so many bad lyrics.
Light-skinned. Is he... He's half black?
Yeah, isn't he black Jewish?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, he's really? A blue. Mm-hmm. there are some good songs, I think.
You see Mark from Jeopardy, 13 episodes in a row, black and Jewish.
Focus, dude.
13 episodes of Jeopardy.
Focus.
All right, sorry.
Unparalleled.
The title track, I think, is the song called Views, is when it's like a 5-minute song when he's like bars and bars and bars, like going. I like when Drake like raps about like, I'm the shit and everything like that. Even though I don't think it's true, it's like, all right, you're actually doing what the Young Money like thing is. That's why you deserve to be on that like posse. But when he's like, you know, oh, I love you, and then he's like raps that shit, it's like, all right, I'm like, if you're a fan of Drake and you like what he does, you're gonna like this album. You know, like that's you're getting what you get for you get with this album. If you want to hear like something like amazing about him, you're not getting it. If you hate Drake, like, don't bother listening to this album. So I'm gonna say like this album is just, it's okay, because I like some songs, I hate some songs. So I'm gonna say download this song album from the whole Stu. What do you think of it?
That's a banishment.
What the fuck's your problem, dude?
Burning.
Why do you hate everything?
I don't hate everything.
Are you racist against Canadians? Why do you hate it so much?
I just don't like it. Okay. I told you I don't really like it. Dude, if you're gonna give me an R&B album, I mean, there's got to be something that you can do with it that would.
There are features too, though. There's features. Rihanna, you got Party Next Door.
Featuring all people I don't care about.
Okay. All right, so you gave your rating, Mark. Bring it home.
Yeah, I pretty much said everything I should say about it. It's kind of pretty bland and stupid.
Stupid.
I wouldn't say fuck it. I would just say skip it, because I don't know.
You didn't like anything on it?
No.
Okay.
But I wouldn't say it's like the worst thing I ever heard, but it's pretty bad.
It's all a right. Fuck it.
Well, we went in a low scale with that album for the most part. I was the most positive, but I thought the album was just, like, mediocre. But what did you think of the album? Let us know in the comment section or send us an email. Do you like the new Drake album? Did you hate it? And tell us what you would actually rate it. One more to go, and then we'll go to some emails. How you guys doing? You all right?
Yeah.
All right, all right.
All right, nice. Shots. Everybody! How you guys doing, man? This is a good show, right? Eating up lots of time, giving you a full show, you guys. Last show, we got to do a little shorter one because we were missing our key component. Snarky Mark was not here to give his opinion.
I mean, the one long-winded person.
Yeah. Did you actually listen to the albums last week?
Okay.
Because I actually thought that PJ Harvey was not that bad, and I thought you would have been there for him.
Oh, PJ Harvey hated that shit.
Yeah. All right. Let's do these shots down.
I didn't like her back then.
Usually, I end
popular.
Usually, I end up like, you know, the impending. I gotta listen to these for the show that's coming up on Sunday is what forces me to listen to these sometimes.
So when do you usually do it though? Take your shot real quick.
Depends.
Okay.
Like I listen to everything here within the last day.
Oh, you do it real close so you don't forget it.
Friday night I listen to Beyonce. Saturday morning listen to Drake, and then today actually I listen to Pepper,
which we're doing right now. Pepper.
Ah,
Pepper.
Salt and Pepper's here.
They're a ska punk reggae band, three piece group from Hawaii, and they formed in 1996.
They're from Hawaii?
Yes.
I don't know.
Listen
shit.
To what I'm saying, man. Don't question anything.
I'm listening. Sorry, I was questioning.
So they formed in 1996, and they were high school friends. Names are Kilo Wasman and Brent Bullinger, and they found a drummer named Yisad Williams, and they relocated to San Diego to pursue their interest in reggae music. Now, in 2002, they released their debut album, Kona Town, which saw a bit of mainstream success with a single, Give It Up, which was like, the lyrics go, why don't you get some high dirt sex to me? Like, that's the reggae thing.
You don't give it justice.
I'm sorry. And after that song, saw them end up playing on the Warped Tour, and they've been in a tour with bands like Less Than Jake, 311, Blink-182, Snoop Dogg, and so on. Now, this album is called Onaha, which is Hawaiian for family, and it is their seventh album, and it's on their label Law Records. And we are going to do our best not to point out how much they sound like Sublime on this.
But not like Sublime in Rome.
Right. We're not going to say how much they sound like Sublime.
They sound like Sublime. We're not
going to say
Sublime in Rome.
We're going to be fair. We're not going to say that because I'm sure they hear that all the time. Ever since that album, that song I mentioned.
I see where your loyalties lie.
Now the song Start You Up, which starts the album off, and other tracks like Never Ending Summer and Vacation deal with like the complexity of maintaining an emotional connection with a loved one in an agreeable environment, which is very existential, right? Let's cut the bullshit. This album is pure Bob Marley-esque reggae with the simple lyrics about girls and sunshine. So you just gotta get some pot, a surfboard, bring some the album to the beach, and just feel the vibes, man. That's all this album's fucking about.
I didn't know you turned into a surfer, dude.
Dude, man, it's just all this out. Dude, I feel the vibes. Get them peppered
on. Dude, they don't even sound like that.
This is what
they don't sound like surfer dudes. They're not the Beach Boys.
Mark, back me up.
It's garbage. They sound like garbage men, if you ask me.
Garbage men.
That's your word. Like autistic garbage men.
Now,
50 Cent would fucking hate this album.
I'm not gonna say I didn't enjoy some songs on this album. Like the guitar upstrokes on the song Vacation, they were a little bit upstroke faster, like more like ska. But this whole album, for the most part, is all like white boy reggae stuff that Undisclosed Band did many years ago.
Yeah, but they're continuing the tradition.
Oh, fine. I love this. You're finally waking up, Stu. This does not show that he's racist whatsoever. This is like, you find out the music he likes, and he'll finally chime in. Like, to be honest, if I heard this album, like, down the shore or on a cruise or something like that, I would like, kind of, like, groove to it. I would not be, like, mad, like, oh, they're playing fucking Pepper. This sucks. I would kind of, like, dance a little bit to it. You can't deny that, Mark. It's, like, infectious in a way.
Deny what? That you would dance to it? Yeah, totally. I'm sure you would.
You!
Me? No fucking way. Are you kidding me?
All right, so I don't have much to say about this band, but Stu, you gotta fucking like save this group.
I like them. I thought they were great, even though they kind of have a sound that sounds like another
extremely
how many,
like
how many bands have sounds that sound like other bands? I mean,
hundreds.
Yeah.
I mean, it happens all the time. It's just called genrefication. Mm-hmm. But so they're the,
but how many bands sound so close that if you put this album on and you say, "Oh, you this
wanna,
is Sublime."
No. You want to like, okay.
Sublime.
You got Sublime. You got Sublime with Rome. You got Bad Fish. You got all this feeding off of that band. Anyway, this band ain't feeding off of them. They just got the same sound.
Is that the same thing, you think?
No, it's not the same thing.
I mean, I don't give it like that. They're from Hawaii. They're from the Bay Area. It's what they are. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm not going to say that. I don't think they're biting off the Sublime sound so much as... Because Sublime, I mean, they've been a band for how long? Like Pepper, they've been since sometime in the late 90s.
Yeah.
So
they're on their 20-year anniversary now. Yeah.
You know, I mean, so they've been doing this long enough that it's not like Sublime was out and they were like, let's fucking do that.
Yeah, it is.
Is it?
It's totally like that. Sublime came out in 1994. Or 1992, sorry. And they formed in 1996.
Well, their
first album was in 2002 when Sublime was dead already.
Instead of doing the regular punk ska thing, they did more of a dub reggae punk thing.
Like Sublime.
Yeah, like
I'm sorry, you guys. I'm totally doing it.
It's just like a little bit of a switch up, and they just happen to do the same thing.
I'm sorry.
They just happen to do the same thing that they. Yeah.
Okay.
I think it's a great album. I think it sounds great. I want to listen to it. It's, if anything, it's like a continuation of if Sublime and Rome actually worked out. I'd rather listen to Pepper than Sublime and Rome.
That's true.
This is the new fill-in for when I want that kind of sound. When I'm in that feeling, Pepper's got it.
Okay. So were there any songs in the album that you like better than others? Or did you like the whole thing as a whole?
No, I like the whole thing in general, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and I listened to it on shuffle, so it's hard to tell what songs. But yeah, I liked everything.
What would you rate it then?
Let's get it. I'll buy it, yeah.
All right, cool. Mark, what would you rate this album? You're looking at my notes. I see you looking.
Oh, no. Okay. Yeah, I mean, going into this week, I didn't know much about any of the artists, like musically. Mm. Obviously, I knew more about Drake and Beyonce's personal lives because of the culture that we live in. But Pepper is a band that I always thought was a rock band.
Mm-hmm.
And a guy I work with who would like to be my friend, but he can go fuck himself, was asking me, well, what albums you got to listen to this week? And I said, Pepper. And he said, oh, they're kind of reggae.
Right.
It's like, he's like, they come out on Sublime Radio.
And you're like, I hate reggae.
It's like, this is the one that I was looking forward to because I thought the other two were going to be garbage. This would be my saving grace rock record. So I put it on, and yeah.
It really is, though. You didn't give it enough chance.
I hate this kind of music. I know that you guys are predisposed to liking ska. You guys like ska. You like this kind of shit.
I got the reggae roots shirt on.
It's the kind of thing where I'm like, don't tell me what I'm supposed to fucking do. Don't tell me I need to go dance at the beach or fucking throw a fucking beach ball around. And to me, it sounds like guys who used to sound like Sublime, who now know how to make music that sounds like that, became dads, went on the fucking Jimmy Buffett tour, and now, like, they're the guy who, with the guitar at the party who's like, all right, everybody, come on now. Let's sing along.
Nobody likes the guy with the guitar at the party.
This is not my kind of music. Generally, it doesn't do anything for me. I don't want to go dance to it. I don't like music that is like, come on, let's all dance and have fun.
I hate fun.
I hate fun music. I don't like it. It's not for me. I don't dance. Setting up my fucking wedding.
Want morbid, kill yourself music.
Uh-huh. But no, I mean, there's a difference between, like, danceable music and then goth.
Typo Negative.
The goth mark comes out.
But like, you know,
this is too happy.
Typo Negative. Where's Typo Negative? Damn it.
We need something depressing.
All right. I mean, I like upbeat music. I just don't like reggae styled stuff. It's not for me. I feel like it's like, especially, I don't know. It's just, it's, to me, it just doesn't do it.
You make Rostas cry.
I say skip this.
You make Rostas cry.
He says skip this. Racist. Now, I'm not to belabor the Sublime point, but if they want to sound like Sublime to me, and they move to sunny California, and they're from Hawaii, I think they live in too much of a happy, positive atmosphere to write some good lyrics. So this is what I think they should take the Bradley Nowell effect or technique of writing music. Bradley Nowell from Sublime. Might suggest they start shooting heroin. And that way they can write some more depressing songs that have more depth and layers and darker tones and not be so generic. So I say, like I said, if I heard this album playing anywhere, like in a fun atmosphere, unlike Mark, I would vibe to it. I wouldn't be like, I would not fold my arms and be like, this sucks. Why they're not playing any Uncle H? Just bullshit.
I was waiting for a punk track to come out.
None.
There was no punk tracks in there. If they were really Sublime, there would have been a punk track thrown in there. I was waiting for that, though.
This is like a watered-down Sublime.
It's like, are they going to like cover Descendants or anything?
Yeah. So I say, man, I kind of agree with your opinion. You said skip this, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Don't do it. Now that I said it's watered-down Sublime, I agree with them. But
no, it's a continuation. There's nothing that is continuing that genre of Sublime other than people that are feeding off of Sublime like Bad Fish and Sublime with Rome, and they're doing now. This is a band that's doing a completely no association with Sublime, doesn't even want to be associated with Sublime, just the same genre.
All right,
so it's a continuation of the genre.
I 160% disagree with you. This band sounds so much like Sublime, except the fact that they are watered down Sublime. And at the same time,
I don't think they're watered down.
At the same time, I enjoyed some songs, so I'm saying you can download it.
I'd like to hear them do a punk track, though.
It's okay.
All right.
So I'm in the middle of
you. Thank you for you almost did a skip it. I had to convince you.
I did, but I was like, you know what? I cannot deny I enjoyed some songs. Mark obviously folded his arms through all 12 tracks or 10 tracks.
Pretty much.
And I was like, I like this song. I don't like this song.
There's one song that I thought actually wasn't the worst. It was why'd you put your notes away? I'm sure that you
I don't know right now. Oh, Vacation was like
no. There was a song in the middle of it that I was like, this isn't terrible. It doesn't matter. It was mostly garbage. It was still bad. It was just not it was not as bad as the rest of it. It had less upstrokes.
Like, my problem is there was not enough ska. It was, like, one ska song, and it was all reggae shit the whole way through. But if you're a Pepper fan, let us know what you think in the comment section, and tell us how great this band is and how we're wrong for comparing them if you're on a Stu bandwagon. If you hate them more than us or you want to have a different opinion, let us know in the comment section. We'd like to know your opinion. Or send us an email. Email us a long-winded story of how great Pepper is or how much they fucking suck. And with that, we're 2 hours in. So
I like Bad Fish, though. Bad Fish is good. Yeah. I was dogging them,
I like the tribute bands are great.
It is good.
All right, so let's get to the emails, and we'll get out of here, you guys. So let's just sign on real quick. Let me get another beer. I am empty of beer. Good show, you guys. I love when there's three of us. It's actually better without
yelling in the background.
I would never listen to this.
It's actually better with like although I like recording at the other studios, it's kind of good to not have the background talk chatter when we do our reviews.
Better hope they don't listen to this.
I hope they do.
I like that Kalinda and Jay are there to fall back on with commentary.
Because
sometimes we need their advice in things.
I really want to know how her trip was, so I guess we'll find out next time we do a show. Hopefully she's here for Memorial Day weekend, and hopefully I can survive the plane ride to Austin and back, because I know I'm going to get very, very drunk and full of barbecue. As you said, it's a great place for barbecue and drinking. Definitely.
You could like get off the plane and there's Salt Lake Barbecue in the airport, and I would highly recommend
Salt that. Lake, I heard, is great, amazing, right?
Salt Lake is, yeah. It's like
but
my
the place you're
mecca.
Talking about that's what the cut the line is something different.
Yeah, I can't remember the name of it. There's J. Mueller's. That's like a big one now. There's a couple other ones.
The place is a 4-hour wait. There's a lot of barbecue. Yeah, places. I can't remember the name of it, but we'll find out when I get. I'll find out when I get there, and I'll post lots of
pictures. Are you logging in on already?
I logged in.
You've got mail.
Got some mail. Great. All right. Now the first email I see here is from Gregory Robertson from Mephiscopheles, and he says, "Jarrell, thanks again for the Mephiscopheles interview. I checked it out on YouTube, so I guess he liked it. One of our bandmates, Brian Martin, called it to my attention that he left behind some equipment at the Highline Ballroom.
Oh, Microphone, wow. Syndrome.
So all this time, little backstory, you guys, I thought someone stole my shit when I did an interview with the band back in March. And it turns out I was too drunk and confused, and I left my shit there. So I ended up buying more equipment to record shows. And you'll find out when you listen to the interview.
Are they going
to
send you the iRig?
I'm going to read it. He asked me to get in touch with you to let you know we have your stuff. We are recording Wednesday night in Midtown, 9 p.m. to 11 p.m., If you get back to me in time, I could let Brian know to bring the gear, and you could pick it up then. If that doesn't work, we can figure another thing out to get your stuff back another time. Now, the issue is, he's in Midtown. I'm in New Jersey. I'm not going to, like, take a train to Midtown to their practice area to get my shit back, especially since I bought it again. And he telling me about that, well, like, 2 months later.
I'll go.
I got more. I got it. I paid for it. It's done. No big deal. So I emailed him back saying, no problem. I got my stuff back. I paid for more stuff. It's cool. And he said, no problem. So I don't know if he's going to get rid of it or not, but I'm happy to know that.
Oh,
I'm
not want, crazy. I want one. I want an iRig Pre.
I went to do an interview with the band PJ Angelo 2 days later. I couldn't find my shit in my backpack. I'm like, where'd it go? Who would steal my shit? But it turns out somehow I got too confused or too excited that Listen Jake was playing the show.
Starstruck.
Yeah, and I lost my shit backstage. And then I literally lost my shit. And it was, like, gone. So I appreciate that you emailed me back, Greg. Thank you so much for being a fan and being courteous.
Oh, yeah, nice. Yeah.
Yeah, that was nice of you to tell me. Awesome. Even though it took it was 2 months later and I replaced my stuff, but I was so despondent and mad when I interviewed the band PJ Angelo. Mm-hmm. I'm so searching through my bag for my stuff, I couldn't find it. I'm like, I can't do an interview now. I have no mics. I can't do it. So I just did an interview with no mics. So you guys hear the interview. It's a lot of background noise, a lot of cars passing, the train comes. You can hear it, but I appreciate you guys listening to the podcast.
You'll have to interview them again.
No, it sounded good. It's not bad.
All right. It's not that bad.
All right. I don't think it's bad. I think it sounds all right, but you posted it, Stu, because Stu was actually my...
I didn't listen to it. I just edited
You just did your shit, man. Do your job. All right, so let's go on another email that I want to say that was
actually... I listened to most of them, but I didn't listen to that one.
Well, also, you got to think of, like, when, like, how did he find the email address? So he probably, like, had to, like, do some research, which you're like, you wouldn't expect someone to
look up email them the interview. Radio. Yeah, in the first place. Yeah.
I'm just saying.
I appreciate that.
You already contacted them.
Yeah, just through email.
I guess. I was trying to get more props.
Yeah. But he actually heard the interview and he liked mm-hmm. it, I think. Yeah, there you go. So, and I checked the views and it's picking up every day. So you guys out there listening to the reviews of Mephiscopheles, they're a great satanic ska band, and they actually were in Austin, speaking of which, last Friday, doing a show. So make sure you check them out. They're touring Texas right now. All right, so this next email is from Adolf Oliver Bush.
Sounds like a real name.
Yeah, and it's to Snarky Mark.
Oh, uh-oh. Hate mail.
And he says, I gather you are an indie rock fan as well as a bit of a movie buff, especially when it comes to renting the right movie. Ha ha, MI5 Jarrell. Good one. Good one, Adolf.
Yeah.
Let's not let that go. Good one. He says, anyway, Mark, I was wondering, what's your favorite indie rock movie? I have two. We Jam Econo. The story of the Minutemen, because I'm a big fan of the band, and I think Dee Boone is just about as much of a legend as Bradley Nowell from Sublime. My other favorite is 1991, the year punk broke. I was a little too young to experience the scene when it took off, so it was really enjoyable to watch a film about the background of the punk rock explosion. Let me know what you think, man. P.S. You're right about the new Gwen Stefani. It does suck ass.
Oh, man. I was right about something. Look at that. I thought it was going to be hate mail. I found a friend.
The one that sends us all the different, like, names. Like, he was... It's the same Barry McCocking you guy. Every time he... I know his email address.
I really should not have the name field and just had, you know, put your email address. We don't care about your fake name.
Don't listen to Stu, man.
I'm going to get rid of that field. Don't, no more name.
Don't do it, man. Whatever you do, whoever you are funny.
Barry with all your, like, you.
Adolf Oliver Bush, that's funny. All right, so...
Oh, go yeah, ahead, but he said your favorite indie rock movie.
I think he's talking about documentaries.
Yes. I mean, I like Hype is pretty good if you're talking about, like, that's like a grunge band one. It's all about, like, you know, Nirvana and Mudhoney and shit.
Want to put you in the mud, honey?
The Pearl Jam documentary, PJ20 or whatever, was actually a really good documentary.
I love that shit.
Yeah. That I thought was really good. And I mean, I don't know. yeah, I mean, the ones he talked about were really good. I mean, if you want to go, like, Decline of Western Civilization. Classic.
Yeah.
I mean,
I thought the second one's about, like, metal, though, right?
Second one's Metal Years. The third one's
how is that one?
Punks. I've never seen the second or third one.
Crust Punks.
They're hard to come by, except this year they finally put them out on DVD and Blu-ray. So, like, it's one of those things where I'm like, I want them, but I'm not going to spend $115 on a Blu-ray set for three punk documentaries. My girlfriend's going to be like, you did what?
We got a wedding to go to.
Spent over $100 on what?
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't know. Any other ones? Spring to
my favorite is obviously Fishbone's, the story of Fishbone that came out like 4 years ago because I think I love... Because
Fishbone's red hot.
Yeah. Besides that, I love when a documentary is so great. If you're not even a fan of the band, you're pulled in to like want to get more music. Now, I can't say that because obviously I was a fan before that, but I took my wife... At the time, with a girlfriend, we went to see them do a screening of that in New Brunswick at Rutgers Theater. And after it was over, she was like, this is amazing. I can't wait to see them in live. I'm really interested in the band now. So
yeah,
that one's great. What can I think of something else, a good documentary? I don't want to pick like one that's like about a particular band. I want to pick the one that's about a particular scene. There's a hardcore one about like... Do you remember
American Hardcore?
Yeah, that one's good. Yeah,
I was just thinking. There's a band called Death.
Yeah, that was really amazing,
good.
Dude.
And then the Devil and Daniel Johnston is another really good music documentary about Daniel Johnston.
Are these indie rock?
Well,
the band called Death is the first like black punk rock band before the Ramones.
Yeah,
and it's like amazing that they were doing that. And they're ahead of their times.
Yeah, but you're doing movies that are.
About
bands, documentaries about bands.
I mean, he said indie rock, but I think that's kind of a hard subgenre to really say. I mean, I don't know. I'm sure there's a Radiohead documentary out there. There's like a, I don't know. But Devin and Daniel Johnston, check that out if you don't know who Daniel Johnston is, because he's basically this like pretty interesting, weird songwriter with schizophrenia who like traveled to Texas. He's like around in the 80s and early 90s, made popular by Kurt Cobain wearing his shirt. Hi, how are you? If you go to Austin, there's actually Austin, because he went to Austin, made it big there. Well, not big. He made a big indie splash there. It took too much LSD with the Butthole Surfers. His dad came to Austin to pick him up because they wanted to bring him back home to like get him mental treatment because he's like crazy. And while they were flying this little two-engine plane, his dad was a pilot, he pulled the keys out of the ignition and threw him out of the fucking airplane, and his dad had to like crash land the airplane, and it's...
They survived.
Yeah. He's still around. He's older, but he's still trying to play music. And that and You're Gonna Miss Me. Now, like thinking of all these other music.
Who's You're Gonna Miss Me?
Rocky Erickson.
Okay.
He was like in the 13th floor elevators in the 60s, and he's like this amazing like psychedelic rock guy who is also kind of just not there mentally. And but it's a great like profile about you know that. So check those out.
Awesome. So you got a lot out there, Adolf. So yeah, check that out. Our final email is from our good old friend David Goldsmith, and he says he's got two questions for you. I've been checking this website for months. When are the damn radio stations coming out? Which I just said I'm gonna post those in
a couple of days. Response.
Yeah.
Oh, figures that's when he asks. He asks right when it's happening.
Yeah. And two, are you guys ever going to get any merchandise?
And yes. Actually, we have merchandise. We
got shirts. We got shirts coming out.
Some people are wearing them right now.
Stu is gonna post the shirts on our website right as soon as you can.
Yeah.
You're backed up with work to do.
No. Well, yeah, it depends what you want done first. You want shirts first, or do you want secret videos edited?
Let's do the shirts second. So the shirts are going to be coming, let's say, in June. You can see the shirts on our website. Go on there. You can purchase them. I'll have the same shirts
in June.
Size. Yeah. The shirts in June, you can pick up size. I think it'll be about $10 a shirt. And I'm going to actually design some more coming in the rest of the summer and into the fall.
You don't even have to. The shirts look awesome.
Well, I'm going to do different ones. Like the hybrid radio thing you posted with the wood background you can see on our website. Mm-hmm. I want to make shirts of those, but they're a little more expensive. But I'll do
them. Yeah, because that's color. I mean, we got black and white t-shirts right now.
And I'm thinking of doing designs and drawings of the actual podcast, the shout-out reviews of our likenesses, and you can get shirts of that as well. So I don't
like that.
Really?
Yeah, my likeness is fugly. I don't want my likeness on anything. Okay. So, well, yeah, we can't talk about that.
Yeah, we'll look like us. You'll know what we look like finally, and it will be.
I'm fine with that then.
So cool. We'll have that done. So, David, thank you for that. That ends the email portion of the show. I see by my wife's searing looks that we should get out of here because we've been about 2.5 hours in.
No, she's not giving you any looks. She just sat down.
Yeah, I thought you have anything to say, Mrs. S? All right, great. Anything to say, Mark? You want to get out of here?
Let's get out of here.
All right, Stu?
Yep.
We had a good show, right?
Till two weeks from
now. I'll come back. I'll have many stories about my Austin trip, as well as we'll have reviews of a lot of metal. Your favorite genre, Mark, metal. All
right.
Rob Zombie, we're going to review the new Rob Zombie.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I've heard that's good, actually.
We're going to review the new Hatebreed album.
Oh. And people were asking why we weren't reviewing Hatebreed this week.
We're backed up with the more popular artists.
Oh, okay.
Which you hated, obviously.
Yeah.
Being a racist and all.
Oh, you get Hatebreed tickets? You going to see Hatebreed?
I was thinking of interviewing them, but I got to ask if it's okay.
Okay, because, you know, they are playing, you know.
Yeah, Starland Ballroom.
WSOU, yeah. Starland Ballroom.
And we're going to review the new Pierce the Veil. So, all metal. So, it'll be a very intense show Memorial Day weekend.
Scars of Envy opening. Ethan's band.
Plug that shit. I don't know what you're talking about.
Scars of Envy. They're opening for Hatebreed.
Oh, okay.
We know them through Cheese Puff Death Crunch.
Yeah, we saw them last year.
Yeah, yeah.
At the what's the place called? Danelle.
Yeah, Roxy and Dukes.
Roxy and Dukes.
It was a metal festival.
I'll be interviewing the Gaslight Gorillaz this Friday.
Oh, I love the Gaslight Gorillaz.
Are you serious?
Yeah, I love the Gaslight Gorillaz.
That was not convincing
at all.
Say it like you're convinced that you like them.
That wasn't convincing?
I believed it.
You did?
That was like Stu actually. Like,
oh, he was excited? I thought it was planned.
No.
To say it. I like the Gaslight Gorillaz.
Yeah, so I'm interviewing him this Friday, so check it out when Stu posts it sometime next week. Until then, let me get out of here, you guys.
They got family in this area. That's why they come back to here.
Here's how to get in touch with us. Go to our website, njhybridradio.net, and go to the contact section and email us or your comments, whatever like that, you have an opinion. Or you want to go to our email address, which is njhybridradio@gmail.com, and post your questions, and I'll read them on the show. Check out our Facebook address, which is facebook.com/NJHybridRadio and like us on there. I like the likes. And you can find us on YouTube and make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel because we need more subscriptions. I like subscriptions. And finally, we got our P.O. box for all bands and the labels that want to send us some promos, which is Hybrid Radio, P.O. Box 297, Raritan, R-A-R-I-T-A-N, New Jersey,
Hurtin',
08869. Until next, or 2 weeks from now, this has been Jarrell. Jerk off Jarrell.
Jerk off Jarrell?
Yeah.
Big League Stew? At least I keep mine consistent.
Yeah. And Snarky Mark saying, have a good 2 weeks, and we'll see you next time. Bye-bye.
Snark on.